Hello everyone. Good morning.
Sir, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Looking very fresh today, sir. I think you have perfect sleep in the night.
आज नहा लिया मैंने.
Yes, we are live now. Over to you, Ajit.
Okay. Very good. Sir, can I share my screen?
Yes, you can do it.
Okay. So, very good morning, everyone. So, we are going to start a webinar on the elbow injuries. So, before I start, I just want to give a brief introduction about the course and about the faculties. So, elbow injuries, we have decided to do this webinar on this topic because the elbow injuries are one of the most common injuries and they are not treated very well. And you know that these have complex ligaments, complex anatomy, and the instability pattern. So these are the reasons why we choose this topic for the discussions. We have wonderful faculty with us. I think this is not going on. Okay. So we have wonderful speakers and faculty with us. We have Dr. John Mukhopadhyay, sir. He doesn't need any kind of introduction. He's very well-known personality in the India as well as abroad also. He's based in Patna, practicing as a orthopedic surgeon, and he's a faculty in the different part, the different corner of the world. So I think, John, it's a pleasure for us. We are blessed and that we have John, sir, with us today. We have next,
pleasure.
Dr. Ram, sir, is with us. Dr. Ram is a consultant in the shoulder and upper limb. Recently, he has joined in the MGM Healthcare. He's trained in the UK. He was a consultant in the UK for around 20 years. He has a huge experience of the upper limb, shoulder, elbow, and wrist injuries. He's a president of the Shoulder and Elbow Society of India, and he's an elected member of the British Shoulder and Elbow Society. We are blessed that we have Dr. Abhijit Vaigaokar, sir. He's my teacher, my mentor. He's based in the Pune. He's a very well-known faculty and the visiting professor in the University of Strasbourg, Taiwan. And he has a lot of publications with his name. Recently, he has formed the Wrist Society of India and he's president of that. So thank you so much, sir, for being with us. It's a pleasure for us to be with you. And the next faculty is Dr. Vikas Gupta, sir. Dr. Vikas Gupta, sir, he is a director and the head of division of the hand and shoulder surgery in the Max Hospital. He has around 50 publications and he's trained from the best institute of the India, like that is the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. He has designed so many locking screws and the plates for the distal radius. We have Dr. Rohan Habbo with us. Dr. Rohan, sir, he's a senior consultant in the Nanavati Super Specialty Hospital. He's trained in the hand and upper limb surgery from the United States and the India from the Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore. We have with us Dr. Satya Vamsi Krishna. Vamsi is my co-fellow and he's my very close friend. He's a consultant in the hand and upper limb surgery in Rajiv Gandhi University of the Health Sciences. He's a fellowship trained upper limb surgeon. He has done the fellowship from the Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore, National University Hospital, Singapore, and the most prestigious institute of Kaplan, that is the Barcelona, Spain. He has numerous publications with his name. We are blessed that we have moderator and panelist, Dr. Nadeem Farki, sir. He's a president of Kanpur Orthopedic Association. Dr. Lamba, sir, is with us. He's a chairman of scientific chairman of Kanpur Orthopedic Association. Dr. Ravi Garg, who is a secretary of Kanpur Orthopedic Association, Dr. Nirbhay Saxena, scientific secretary of KOA. We are blessed that we have Dr. Apoor Agrawal, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us. He's a president of UP Orthopedic Association. Dr. Sanjay Dhawan, sir, he will join us. He's a president of elect UPOA. Dr. Jamal Asraf, sir, who is immediate past president of UPOA, and Dr. Anoop Agrawal, sir, he's a secretary of UPOA. So before starting presentations, there's a Zoom etiquette that all your microphones have been muted and videos turned off. Zoom users, please send their questions through the chat box. The moderator, like me and Dr. Rabiga, will ask the question, will review the questions and they as they appear and present them to the faculties. Viewers on the Ortho TV and YouTube can ask the questions through the WhatsApp number mentioned here. Please ask questions related to the discussion's topic only. So the learning objective of this webinar is that demystifying the elbow instabilities and significance of the ligamentous injuries, recognize the significance of the injuries of the elbow in the pediatric age group, understand the fracture pattern of the coronary and its significance in the stability of the elbow, to understand the limitation of the radial head replacement and importance of the open reduction internal fixation, and recognize the CF fracture of the distal humerus. With this, thank you so much. I will stop my sharing my screen. I will request Dr. Anoop Agrawal sir, Apoor Agrawal sir, for a message from the UPO Orthopedic Association. Apoor sir, are you listening to me? Okay. Neeraj sir?
Yes, I've unmuted him.
Yeah, so.
Thank you, Ajit. You, I am audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Your voice is cracking, sir.
Thank you, Ajit. I welcome you all on the UPO Orthopedic Association. And I congratulate Kanpur Orthopedic Association, Dr. Nadeem Faruqi, and Dr. Ajit Tiwari for arranging this nice webinar. My special thanks to the all learned speakers that they have spared their valuable time. Thank you very much. Now I request Dr. Anoop Agrawal to say a few words. Dr. Anoop, please.
Neeraj sir?
Yeah, he has the opportunity to unmute himself.
Okay, I'm so sorry. I'll unmute it myself. So congratulations, Kanpur Orthopedic Association, for organizing such a wonderful webinar. Elbow is a complex joint, we all know, and managing these joints carefully is very, very important. And I'm sure with the learned faculty, we have like Dr. Vikas, Dr. John Mukhopadhyay, Dr. Ram, Abhijit, Rohan, and Satya, and yourself, Ajit, will be able to really justify and learn more and more about the elbow. So I hand over to you, Ajit, again, and congratulations, and thank you for giving us an opportunity to do it under the UPOA.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your kind word. Now I will request Dr. Nadeem Faruqi, sir. He is a president of Kanpur Orthopedic Association. Sir, kindly welcome at this.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the first webinar being organized by the Kanpur Orthopedic Association, in association with Regency Hospital, Kanpur, under the aegis of UP Orthopedic Association. Dr. Ajit Tiwari has worked very hard. We have a host of eminent faculty from all over India. The topics have been chosen so that which are of common interest to most of the orthopedic surgeons. And I'm sure it'll be a very good interactive session and there'll be a lot of learning from this webinar. I'm very grateful to the faculty from all over India who have joined in to teach this complex, to deliberate on the elbow injuries. I'm very grateful to all of you who have joined in, and I'm sure there are a lot many more about to join in. Welcome all of you, and I hand over again to Dr. Ajit Tiwari to... Okay, Dr. Ajit tells me that we need to start off with the first session, and Dr. Rohan Habbu is going to speak on distal humerus fractures.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, Ajit, thank you so much. Thank you to the UPOA and the Kanpur Orthopedic Association. Today, my topic would be distal humerus fractures and shear fractures. I have no disclosures or any conflict of interest. And the objective of the talk would be the fixation principles. And I would try to keep it case-based rather than going into theory. For any distal humerus fracture, you need good x-rays. An AP and a lateral view suffices. Occasionally, you can get an internal oblique view to assess the lateral column. for us in our practice, we almost always get a CT scan done for all the elbow fractures that we see. Maybe a few where we are sure of the fracture geometry, we will not do a CT scan. What we have learned over the last 7 years of practice is there's no hurry to operate a distal radius fracture, provided it's a closed fracture and that there is no neurovascular deficit. So we usually aim for above elbow slab, get all the investigations done, and we usually operate at about the fifth or the seventh day. What we remember is a distal humerus, unlike the knee joint, is a very small bone. It has a very small bone stock and has a complex anatomy. We use the AO classification primarily to classify and for research purpose. For treatment purpose, we use a simple classification where we describe it as an extra-articular or an intra-articular fracture. For the extra-articular, we look at it as whether it's a high condylar or a low condylar fracture, depending upon whether it traverses above or below the olecranon fossa. Intra-articular fractures commonly we know are the TY fractures. And the very rare fractures would be the shear fractures where the fracture line exits within the capsule or within the joint itself. Almost always we would approach the distal humerus when the patient is in a lateral position. We approach it through a posterior approach, occasionally to fix the lateral side of the elbow, we would approach it through a lateral incision. My go-to approach is the olecranon osteotomy for all the intra-articular fractures. For extra-articular fractures, we elevate the triceps on both sides and isolate the ulnar nerve. In my practice, I've not used the triceps reflecting, that is a trap approach ever. 2 points on the ulnar nerve, I would transpose it for a distal humerus fixation only if there are preoperative ulnar nerve symptoms. If the nerve is in contact with the metal after the fixation is complete, or if the nerve is subluxating after the fixation is complete. Otherwise, I would leave the ulnar nerve in place. Now, coming to the actual fracture patterns, we will go one by one. Extra-articular high condylar fractures are quite common. We approach this through a posterior approach with the patient lying in a lateral position. These are quite accessible and amenable by elevating the triceps on both the sides after isolating the ulnar nerve. We usually prefer to mobilize the fracture early. Occasionally, if you're happy with the fixation with one plate, you can let it be. Also, always you remember you should have a consent for bone graft ready. We have had about 7 patients in the last 7 years, where 6 of them had good range of movement. One patient ended up with a delayed union. This was the one which we had not bone grafted, and he also had severe stiffness. Now, the low condylar fractures, which are extra-articular, that means which exit at or below the olecranon fossa, can be treated in 3 different ways. Occasionally, you can treat them non-operatively. We had 3 patients, and all of them had some preoperative comorbidity. 2 of them had bad blood coagulation disorders, and we were worried that doing an open reduction may cause more complications. We have had fair results with above elbow plaster cast for 6 weeks, followed by gradual mobilization. And this is one example of a patient who's had a good extension on healing, but he has limited flexion to about 120 degrees. But this is better than having wound complications. Occasionally, we have treated the low condylar fractures with close reduction and K-wiring. These are primarily senior citizens who have very poor skin. The bones can be subcutaneous and implants can be an issue. This is a lady who presented to us with a delayed union, and we ended up doing a close reduction and K-wiring. And this is at about 1 month from K-wire removal. She has about a fixed flexion deformity of 30 degrees and further flexion up to 100 and 110 degrees. However, the commonly done procedure for low condylar fractures would be an open reduction and internal fixation. We usually preserve this for young patients with a good robust skin. and a very good bone stock. We approach these fractures through a posterior approach. Here, a triceps elevating approach is adequate after dissecting the ulnar nerve. You can fix them with parallel plates. That means plates which are placed on the condylar ridges on both the sides. And these allow you to mobilize the patients early rather than late, giving good results. Occasionally, you would have fractures which would exit on one side below the olecranon fossa, on the other side above the olecranon fossa. Again, these patients can be treated by a posterior approach without doing an olecranon osteotomy. Isolate the ulnar nerve, release the triceps from both the sides, and we prefer parallel plating in these fractures. Honestly, I would almost always bone graft these fractures because this ensures that they have good healing early. Coming to the TY fractures, which are very commonly seen, we have had occasions where we have treated them non-operatively. We give them casts from 3 to 6 weeks. These are primarily patients, again, who have had very poor comorbidities like ejection fractions, less than 20%, poor skin conditions, poor coagulation profiles. We have had 8 patients whom we treated. 5 of them went on to unite. 3 of them didn't unite. But of these, only 2 had minor pain, but they were able to do their day-to-day activities. There are good papers to suggest that non-operative management occasionally in a low TY fractures of the elbow does give decent results. However, commonly we end up fixing these fractures. Again, they are done in a lateral position with the arm hanging over the support. You end up putting a sterile or an unsterile tourniquet depending upon how proximal we would extend our incision. We almost always go posterior approach and through an olecranon osteotomy. We either use a 90-90 plating. We used to use this when I started my practice about 7 to 8 years ago, but nowadays we have shifted to a parallel plating and we'll talk about it a little later. This was one of the earlier cases where we used a triceps elevating approach. We ended up fixing the intra-articular segment. It was not displaced much on CT scan, and hence we could get away without doing an olecranon osteotomy. And we did a 90-90 plating after putting in the intracondylar screw. Again, a similar case where we ended up doing a triceps elevating approach, but here we did a parallel plate. The difference between the two is while using a parallel plate, the intracondylar screw that you pass may be passed through the plate, okay? And with the studies by the Mayo Clinic, they have put in guidelines about how we address these fractures. They say that the intercondylar screw through the plate provides a better fixation. All the screws should engage the opposite cortex and try and use as many screws as possible. This is a very unusual, this is not my case, this is from the textbook. We usually don't use an olecranon plate for an olecranon osteotomy. I have used this just for references where the olecranon was fixed with an olecranon plate. I would always use a TBW wiring for an olecranon osteotomy. Occasionally, as you go, you'll get a fracture which exits fairly low. This could be something like a lateral condyle fractures. For me, this is a very unusual pattern in an adult. We commonly see these in kids. We have seen just one case in the last 7 years. However innocuous it looks, remember, there would be a significant displacement and a step when you do a CT scan. We always need a fixation by an open reduction. 2 things you remember: take care of the radial nerve as you grow proximal, and also maintain the integrity of the lateral ulnar collateral ligament. Almost always when you elevate the lateral condyle, you will end up having a big defect. Keep the bone graft ready. I've not seen an isolated medial condyle, that is the isolated trochlear fracture in my practice, but the studies show that a posterior approach is quite good to fix a trochlear fracture. The shear fractures are quite uncommon, given the amount of elbow injuries that we see. These are the fractures that typically remain within the joint or exit just at the capsular margin. These could be the capitellar fractures, the shear the trochlear fractures, or complex fractures. We have had about 6 capitellar fractures over the last 6 years. They're quite uncommon. I'm talking about isolated capitellar fractures. X-rays, we may miss these fractures, so always get a CT scan done. We have about the common ones are the type 1, where there is a significant subchondral bone and you can get good fixation. Type 2 is where you just have a shear of subchondral bone. Type 3 is, which is associated with the trochlea. I haven't seen that in my practice. And type 4 is a comminuted one. We usually approach this through an extended focus approach. It's quite simple because the capitellum is right there. The problem is to maintain the lateral ulnar collateral ligament and not cut it. Try and keep the dissection on the posterior aspect as minimal as possible. And we end up fixing it with the headless compression screws. We have done about 4 of them for type 1, and 2 of them have developed AVN of the capitellum, but they are painless at about 3 months. The type 2 and 4, which you had excised, ended up having a poor result. So going into the literature, we saw these fixed with wires, sutures, and supplemented with X-fix. The shear fractures can be complex fractures. These can involve the capitellum, trochlea, collateral ligaments. A CT scan is always must to identify the fracture geometry. We have had 3 fractures, isolated shear fractures. 2 of them were about 80 years, and we end up treating them with the bag of bones technique. That means by just immobilizing them in a loose plaster slab. We have had done 1 ORIF where we approached it through a posterior approach with an olecranon osteotomy and fixed both the trochlea and the capitellum. In the literature, you will find arthroplasty as a mechanism to treat the comminuted poor quality distal elbow fractures, but I have not had an experience with this. X-fix is primarily used as an adjunct for fixation of small fractures. So in summary, imaging is important, whether to do a CT or an X-ray will give you will define the fracture geometry. It allows you to decide the type of fracture, decide the approach, non-operative, close reduction, or an open reduction. But whatever you do, try and fix it well. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Ajit.
Thank you, Dr. Habbo. That was an excellent talk. The next speaker is Dr. Ram Chidambaram. He'll speak on coronoid fractures, and we'll have questions for both the speakers at the end of the second talk.
Thank you.
Dr. Ram Chidambaram.
Yes, thank you. Can you?
Ma.
Okay. Good morning. Thank you, Ajit Tiwari, for the kind invitation. And the greetings to Kanpur Orthopedic Association and UP Orthopedic Association for the joint venture. My talk is about coronoid fracture. So I'll start giving my lecture, thanking my gurus in elbow surgery from whom I learned the principles and practice from none other than Dr. Sean Wood is called from Mayo Clinic, and also my mentor, Dr. Daniel Mock from the UK. So let us look at case scenario straight into a 40-year-old man. This was the index X-ray. The patient presented to me at a later stage. So he had a radial head fracture, olecranon fracture, and also a coronoid fracture, as you see here. He had a 3D CT at the time, and he underwent surgery elsewhere in Chennai with this type of configuration. Had a radial head excision, no ligament repair, a transarticular wire, a patient put in POP cast for 1 month, really leading to this sort of outcome. 2 years later, he just presented to me, is the current situation is that ankylosed elbow. This is actually a video, but it is looking like a still because there is no movement in the elbow. It's a very, very challenging problem now. Why did this happen? Because you should understand the elbow anatomy. Let us go through some basic principles. This is the biomechanics of coronoid. The ulnar trochlear joint is the main key joint, and the coronoid forms the anterior buttress for the elbow and is a restraint to the posterior dislocation. The anatomy of the coronoid, you should look at it. The coronoid tip is intra-articular and there is no attachment to the tip. The capsule is attached 6 millimeter distal to the tip. If there is just a tip of coronoid fracture, don't panic, it doesn't need addressing. Brachialis is inserted till further. But the most important bit is MCL attachment. This is the medial collateral ligament. There are three bands. The key band we talk about is the anterior band that connects the medial epicondyle to the sublime tubercle. That is the base of the medial aspect of the coronoid process. This is called MUCL, that is medial ulnar collateral ligament. This is the primary valgus stabilizer of the elbow. On the lateral side, you have three ligaments, a radial collateral ligament and a lateral ulnar collateral ligament, or LUCL, which connects the lateral epicondyle to the ulna. And annular ligament is just a reinforcement over the radial head. So if you look at it, the LUCL gives the restraint to the posterolateral rotational force. So to summarize, you just take this important slide back home. Number one, ulnar trochlear joint is the key joint. And second, you have two stabilizers on either side, LUCL on the lateral side, MUCL on the medial side, and the coronoid is a key anterior buttress. The secondary static dynamic constraint is done by radiocapitular articulation with the radial head contributing to 60% of the load. So you have to look at the coronoid fracture. The coronoid fracture has been traditionally classified by Regon and Murray in 1989 like this. But this arbitrary classification is based on a single lateral view X-ray. It doesn't tell you about the other injuries. Remember, coronoid fracture rarely happens in isolation. It is always mostly associated with the instability of the elbow, dislocation, or other fracture. We are not talking about coronoid fracture alone. So there are three concepts. There is a posterolateral rotation, there's a posteromedial rotation, and there's a transvolic Renan force. So based on this assumption and observation, Sean Waterschool quoted this classification. This is widely practiced now from 2003. Either it could be a tip fracture, which is a smaller tip or a larger tip, depending upon the force of the rotation. Second is the anteromedial facet fracture. This typically occurs in a posteromedial rotation instability. We'll talk about that when the radial head is intact. And third is the basal fracture. It could be a basal fracture or it could be associated with polychron. This classification makes you understand the elbow anatomy and address the coronoid fracture. But if at all you see one, how to fix coronoid? There are all sorts of approaches. You could approach through lateral if the radial head is broken, or medial for anteromedial face fracture, or posterior through olecranon fracture, or anterior if it is an isolated coronoid fracture. So I have done all these approaches. We will show example of four cases. This is the anteromedial approach where you go in the pronator teres brachialis interval and you incise the anterior half of the flexor pronator mass. And second is the posteromedial approach. This is in this approach, you have to expose the ulna, transpose if needed, and you incise the FCU distal to the sublime tubercle and reach the base of the coronoid. Radial side approach is done after you excise the radial head or the radial head fragment moved, and then you can fix it. Transolecranon approach is through posterior when there is associated olecranon fracture. What to fix with? You have a lot of options. Screw fixation, retrograde fashion, anchor fixation, plate, special coronoid plate has been available. I've been using in UK, but we can use all the other stuff as well from the hand fixation set. So let us look at the four cases for illustrating this understanding of anatomy and how to deal with that. The first is a 54-year-old gentleman after road traffic accident, very swollen elbow, and that is the plain X-ray finding, as elegantly pointed out by Rohan Habu. We just do a CT scan. The CT scan profile view front, that shows you the coronoid process fracture. But you see there is a radial head fracture, major fragment, and another couple of fragment, and there is a gross dislocation. This is classical, called terrible triad. I have a coronoid fracture, radial head fracture, elbow dislocation. The mechanism of injury is this: posterolateral instability, fall on outstretched hand, axial load, the relative elbow extension, put the hand, elbow into valgus, and there is a forearm supinatory force. So what does this do? you might hear this sort of instability injury explanation again repeatedly in this next 2 hours, but it is important. Repetition is good in elbow. This is the Hori's cycle of instability. First, the LUCL rupture, and then the rotatory force, posterolateral direction, ruptured the anterior-posterior capsular tear. Okay. In this approach, the elbow dislocates now, starting to have an impaction fracture of capitulum, or the radial head itself gets broken, or the coronoid tip is broken. Most often, the tip of the coronoid broken is either the lateral part of the coronoid, or it is the base. And finally, if the injury continues, you have a MCL tear and a soft tissue muscle tear. So this is the classification. So if you look at this X-ray like this, you know, we have to be remembering these things. LCL tear, MCL tear, muscle tear, they are not seen on the X-rays or the CT scan. So it is very important to include EUA or examination under anesthesia. I will also talk about that. So how to treat terrible triad of elbow? This is my principle. First one, repair the LCL. That is a key ligament torn. And second, fix or replace the radial head fracture. Get the buttress back. Fix coronoid if you think it's a displaced fragment or it's unstable in the anteroposterior direction. Finally, check EUA stability. If unstable, opening up, you repair the medial side. Otherwise, you could treat that conservatively. For radial head fracture fixation, Ajit Tiwari is going to talk in detail. Fixation is my first choice because it preserves the anatomy, chance of healing, no overstuffing, an arthritic expanded head still function well and doesn't burn bridges. And we have a lot of choices now in India. It's a headless compression screw in different sizes. We have a pre-contoured locking plate, rim head plates available. And I also use the hand system plate with the multiple options of varying screw sizes and plate shapes, geometry. So what do they do for this patient? This is the case. So we did a lateral approach. When you see these approaches for a traumatized elbow, as you open the skin, you would see the LCL ligament is torn and the anatomy is open to you. You don't need to make a lot of tissue plane to dissect to reach to the radial head. So I just moved away the big chunk of radial head fragment and I put a screw. I saw the coronoid is a big fragment. So I tried to fix it with a retrograde approach, percutaneous screw from the back of the ulna to reach the reduced coronoid. Okay? So that's the radial head fixation with the pre-contoured radial head ring plate along with the headless screw fixation. And you have to fix it to your satisfaction. That means the patient should have good range of flexion extension and also good forearm rotation because the patient has to mobilize the elbow. Otherwise, the results would not be good. So that is the LCL repair with the suture anchor. You could also do this with the transosseous sutures in the lateral epicondylar ridge. So that is the final result after repairing of the coronoid retrograde fashion and radial head fixation with the headless screw and the radial head plate. That is the range of flexion extension the patient has on table and also the amount of rotation you could check it. Once you check the stability, then you could let the patient have, if very much a swollen elbow, I let them have a plaster for about a week and then start mobilization as comfort allows. This is typically the patient's movement at 2 weeks post-operative. They slowly increase the range of movement. The terminal flexion you might not get, but they would get a good, terminal extension might be difficult, but you would get a good range of flexion. So moving on to the next case, 25-year-old lady after accident. Again, you see the coronoid is broken, dislocated head, and radial head fracture, terrible triad, very grossly swollen elbow, very much unstable. So you do a 3D CT front profile picture, you would see the coronoid. This picture view is important for you to understand the coronoid, where it is broken. Here, if you see, it's a lateral part of the coronoid, not the medial part. So this is coming under Schoenwort response classification type 1. So if the radial head here is very much damaged, it is not fixable, then we have to replace. So, but none of the radial head option is very good because the radial head morphology is complex. It is not reliably reproduced by any prosthesis. It's an elliptical head, head neck offset is there, neck length different, fixation to stem is an issue, and able to tolerate torque force. But in a trauma situation, what we see is to have a spacer-like prosthesis and never overstuff the joint because that can cause arthritis. So here I did the lateral approach. Again, as you see, I'm just showing it. You just open the skin and you will see the radial head, capitulum, everything under the And you have to remove all the radial head fragments broken, because if you leave it few fragments, they can lead to heterotopic ossification post-op. So that's radial replacement. As I said, do not overstuff. If you are doubtful, put a smaller size radial head prosthesis. So check the stability. And also, if you see, I did the repair of LCL. And as you see, I'm just screening it. As soon as you put the radial head in, the elbow is stable. So this is the pattern of injury. You fix or replace the radial head that restored the stability. Now, there is a small tip fracture of the coronoid process, so I left it alone. But on coronal plane screening, I found the medial side joint opening up. So I put a smaller incision there, and MCL was completely torn. The flexor origin was also torn. So repaired it using a suture anchor. So that is this patient that 1 month post-operative, is a video playing. So that's the 1 month he recovered full movement afterwards. So this is another case to show, 23-year-old man, road traffic accident. He didn't come early. He came to me 2 months ago, 2 months later. So the right elbow remaining dislocated. He had a native treatment with oil bandage, swollen elbow, unstable. The flexion is only that much, what you see on the video. And that is his x-ray. So he's a persistent dislocated elbow. The patient had an MRI scan outside. So he came with the pictures. You could see the CT scan is the ideal here. But because he had an MRI scan, it shows all the information. I didn't seek for further information. So if you see that here, there is a big coronoid fracture, and the elbow, the distal femoral condyle is sitting on the locked at the displaced coronoid fracture. And as you see, all the rest of the ligaments are torn. Is unreduced posterior dislocation, LCL and MCL is torn, some impaction fracture of capitulum, but it's a displaced big coronoid fracture. And also early heterotopic ossification because the patient presented at 2 months. This is all a challenging in elbow instability because of late presentation. So what is this? So this is varus postromedial rotator instability. So this mechanism is different. First, again, the LCL is torn. And because of that, it hit the coronoid, hit against the trochlea, and you have a facetal fracture. So that is the antromedial facetal fracture, Schoenwood Riskolf type 2, where you have involvement of the sublime tubercle as well, depending on the force. The radial head is usually intact in this injury, as you saw in this particular patient presentation. As the injury goes further, the anterior medial collateral ligament also can rupture. So this is the principle. Number one, fix the coronoid fracture because that is the key. And second is repair the lateral collateral ligament. And finally, you repair the MCL if indicated, if there is a persistent opening of the joint space. So that is my medial approach to, is the Hotchkiss approach to fix the coronoid. Here I have used a two-hold plate. I used to do a pre-contoured plate, but here I have used the hand system plate and two screw fixation. Once I fix the coronoid, I look for stability. You see how much the elbow is stable. The range of movement you could see on screening. It's pretty stable in the anteroposterior plane. So I finished the medial side surgery, MCL repair, and flexor origin repair as well because it's all torn. And I assessed the lateral side was the opening there. So I went in there. I did the repair of lateral collateral ligament as well. I have a very low threshold of repairing medial or lateral collateral ligament if there is a doubtful opening of the joint space. So this is the post-operative for him. You could see the couple of screws and a small plate fixing the anteromedial facet, as well as you would see some sort of a heterotopic bone on the back of the elbow. I didn't disturb that because I let them move as early as possible because I have addressed all the pathology, fixed the coronoid, repaired the medial collateral ligament, repaired the lateral collateral ligament. So it is actually a stable elbow. So why not move early? So this is the patient moving early, 2 weeks post-operative, have a free bandage and start mobilizing. That is the range of movement. He's able to eat with his right hand, so he's happy. And this is his follow-up x-ray and clinical results at 8 weeks.
Two months
at post-surgery. He didn't get full extension, but he got reasonably good extension, about 30 degrees to 120 degrees flexion, which is enough for day-to-day purpose with elbow movement. And mind you, there is a small heterotopic ossification, but as far as you move the elbow, the heterotopic ossification doesn't bridge and you could have very good range of movement. The last the case, we show a 35-year-old man from Andaman, 6 weeks after the road traffic accident, with this fracture he came in. This is a basal coronoid fracture. Associated with polychromal fracture. So this is Schoenwood response type 3 fracture pattern. And it's got a significant swelling and it's a delayed presentation too. So this is the CT scan. As you see, it's a large chunk coronoid. So here is where we go posterior direction. So the principle is fix the coronoid fracture through posterior approach and you complete the polychromal fixation following that. So this, I have done the coronoid fixation. The olecranon piece is on the top retracted and the coronoid fracture is reduced with the pointed reduction forceps. And I have put two screws through the fractured surface to catch the coronoid fragment and fix it to the base. Then we have to close and do a olecranon fixation. But the problem here is he has got significant comminution of the olecranon. So here I decided to do a shortening osteotomy of the olecranon. This you could do, you could excise, resect 20% of the articular surface of the olecranon without compromising the elbow. So I've done a shortening of the osteotomy of the olecranon and a matching surface of the olecranon, I did a tension band wire fixation. So there you could see the screw fixation to fix the coronoid, the articular congruity is restored and the tension band wiring. So this is the patient that 5 day post-operative. The very important thing is to mobilize early. The patient typically get a range of movement from about 20 to 120 range. The final there will be some final restriction because the arc of the articulation is reduced. So to summarize, elbow injury dislocations, scrutinize the plain X-ray first of all for coronoid fracture. If unstable dislocation, you suspect more extensive bony or ligament injury. Ligament injuries are not seen on the X-rays or the CT scan. So it is important to see it, evaluate the 3D CT to understand the pathology if you think the coronoid is involved, because that will tell you whether it is the anteromedial facet fracture or a lateral tip fracture or a base fracture. Very important thing is if it is the anteromedial facet fracture, if it is displaced, you have to address it because this is the condition leading to arthritis later on if neglected. And don't hesitate to do an examination under anesthesia at every instance to decide the next step of treatment. And my practice, I have a low threshold of repairing concomitant injuries and advise early mobilization. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ram. That was an excellent talk and it made it look very simple. I mean, you look at your operations, it was very easy to do these fractures. Practical experience, with very limited practical experience, I can tell you that they are not so easy to treat as Dr. Ram has shown, but definitely experience helps. And there's a question for you from Dr. Manish Trivedi. He wants to know, for lateral collateral ligament repair, which graft are you using?
Well, for this acute scenario, the lateral collateral ligament is usually avulsed from the humeral attachment. You could do a direct repair using a suture anchor. These days you have a screw type or knotless or all suture type. You could use that. The second option is to use a transosseous anterior posterior drill hole tunnel, simplest technique. Now the question of grafting comes in only when it is a chronic retracted tear where you cannot meet end to end or attach to back to the asymmetric point. In those cases, I use a graft. But I take a Pomeroy's longus graft. You might say that it is not adequate, but I would reinforce with the internal brace. That means you put an anchor in the humeral condyle, put the anchor in the ulna, use an internal brace and have this Pomeroy's longus graft as a reinforcing structure.
Thank you. There's one more question. Is there a role of conservative treatment in this sort of injuries?
Yes, absolutely. You have a terrible triad injury, minimally displaced radial head fracture, and the elbow is dislocated, relocated back, and you have a tiny tip avulsion of the coronoid. You check for the stability. If the patient is able to flex and extend from 30 to 100 degree and stable, you could treat them conservative as well.
Okay, and then another question is,
What are the long-term results of radial processes? This is from Dr. Nirbhay Saxena.
We routinely do that in trauma situation. The results are pretty good. I think Ajit Tiwari is going to talk.
But the thing
to remember is that we do not have multiple options in India for radial head prosthesis. We have only one or two companies, and it is titanium prosthesis, because I have used before pyrocarbon and other stuff, but here we have only titanium prosthesis. But as in the trauma situation, the result is pretty good. Ajit Tiwari is going to talk about it.
Yeah, I'll talk about this. Ram sir, there's one question for you that how do you manage if someone has a fracture of the coronoid along with the sublime tubercle? Do you use plates, or what is your preferred method of fixation of the
plate? Is the best option. The original coronoid plate was devised by Sean Woodrich Call, is available as Acumate plate. We have a hoop over the front of the sublime tubercle, and you had to fix only the distal port of the plate screws. But now we don't have that available. I use a T plate from the hand system, mold it, and then use it with the 2-3 screws for the coronoid base and 2 screws distally. The plate is the best system. If you do the over the top approach, you could easily see the fraction in plate.
Okay, so your preferred mode of fixation of the coronoid, do you go from the medial side or from the lateral side?
If the radial head is broken, and if you have a 2-piece radial head and it is coming out freely, you could go via that radial head approach to fix it, but it is always difficult. But it is easier if you have to excise the radial head, you're going to do a radial head replacement, then you could see the coronoid clearly, you could fix it, but not always when the head is fractured. When the head is fractured, sometime I go fix the lateral side and go medially for the coronoid.
Do you use Boyd's approach or the lateral caucus approach for the fixation of a coronoid?
For the coronoid?
No. Why would you use that?
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
You would use the posterior approach if it's a transolecranon.
Yes. Only.
For the terrible triad.
Okay. Yeah. Posterior approach is, in my practice, I only reserve it for posterior transolecranon fracture dislocation.
Okay, so one question for the Rohan sir, for you, that what is your preferred mode of fixation of capitulum fracture? Do you fix from the posterior to anterior or anterior to posterior?
Unmute.
I've always done fixed it temporarily from anterior to posterior because the dissection is easier. And then when you want to do a final fixation, you just pass the guide wires from posterior to anterior so that, you know, it's just about 2 millimeter or 2.4 millimeter dissection posteriorly.
Okay. Sometimes we encounter that there's a fracture, there's a longitudinal, fracture of the capitulum along with trochlear fracture is also there. So what's your preferred mode of fixation? Do you do the lateral condyle osteotomy, lateral epicondyle osteotomy, and fix the trochlear and the capitulum together? Or how do you go with these kind of fractures?
Okay, so in my practice, I've not seen trochlear fractures or the type 3 of the capitular fractures. But if you look at the literature, the best fixation would be to do an olecranon osteotomy. Go posterior, do an olecranon osteotomy. You will be able to see the trochlea better, the reduction of the trochlea better from the posterior side rather than doing it only from the lateral side. But if you're sure that it's one single fragment, okay, a big fragment, and you're confident that you will be able to visualize the trochlear side of the fracture by opening the lateral approach, through a lateral approach, then you can go in. But if I get it, I would go posterior.
So can I just add to that a little bit?
Yes, sir.
Please go ahead.
Okay, so I think it really depends on the fracture configuration. So these ones, you really need the CT to understand the fracture. And depending on that, you either go lateral or posterior. So where you go posterior, yes, you do an olecranon osteotomy. The other option sometimes is to actually do a dual approach, medial and lateral. Okay, so when you have the fracture extending, because most of the fractures anterior and sometimes through the back, it's very difficult to visualize your reduction adequately. So some of these, so you need to study the CT very carefully and then decide on your approach. And it could be a combined medial and lateral in some of these ones, okay? So we've had to deal with quite a few of them in our practice over the years. They're not common fractures, but over the years, we've had to deal with quite a few of them.
Abhijit sir, what's your take on these? Abhijit sir, are you listening to me?
Some disturbance coming from somewhere.
Dr. Ravi sir is there? Dr. Ravi?
Yeah. Now, welcome to all learned speakers. Now we start from the second session. Dr. Ajit Tiwari would take to lecture on the radial head fracture. So, Ajit, ready for your screens here?
Yeah. We'll start. So, actually, before starting my talk, I just want to thank Dr. Ram Chidambaram, sir. For, thank you so much, sir, for being with us, because I know that you are busy in some other international webinar.
Thank you.
I thanks a lot for being with us, sir. It's a great pleasure.
Thank you, Ajit. Thank you, sir.
So nice. Now we are going to start my talk. So radial head fractures, this is the most common elbow fractures, around 33% of the elbow fractures. And you know that 1 to 5.
Your screen is not here.
My screen is not here?
Yeah.
You haven't opened the presentation. You need to open the presentation.
Open the presentation. Your presentation is not open.
Okay.
So you need to open it before you do your screen share. Okay.
Okay.
So go back, stop sharing, open your presentation, and then go to screen share again. Okay.
In the meantime, one
question. Open your presentation and then.
In the meantime, one question to Dr. Ram.
Yes.
What are the absolute indication for the radial head prosthesis in radial head fractures?
So that is my talk. I'll tell you.
Okay. One. My question to Dr. Rohan. Rohan is unmute.
Yes.
What are the main indication for the parallel plating instead of that orthogonal plating in distal radius fracture, distal humerus fracture?
The cadaveric studies and anatomical studies have shown that it is a parallel plate are better and have lower risk of non-union as compared to orthogonal plating. That is 1990. Okay. We started off with orthogonal plating, but now in the last 2 or 3 years, we have been doing parallel plating. You get good compression. You can get good reduction. You can pass the intercondylar screws through the plate. And that's what the Mayo study has shown, that it will give you a good stable fixation and you can start mobilizing early.
Okay, that is no criteria for the parallel plating or orthogonal plating. It's a surgeon's choice.
It's a surgeon's choice, but most of the fractures are now amenable to parallel plate. Means with the new profile, profile plates that you have, they're quite low profile and they do help.
Okay. Yeah, but now Dr. Ajit will start
yes.
your talk.
Okay.
Thank you,
okay.
Dr.
Yeah. So, John, sir, you want to say something? John, sir?
So, I just wanted to just add that I think in the studies that have shown some advantage are all biomechanical studies. In real terms, in clinical studies, there's no real advantage or disadvantage, except in the very low fractures. There, the parallel plating has an advantage. If you have a very low transcondylar type of fracture, that's the parallel plating has a definite advantage. And on the other side, the plates that we have today give you the advantage of being also able to, so the lateral radial plate also comes with a side, this thing, which you can put across the joint as well as back to front screws. So if you have a coronal shear fracture, then the orthogonal plate has some advantages. Okay, so there are some differences in certain fracture patterns, but it's mostly surgeon choice and training that dictates what you do. Okay.
So can I start my talk?
Yes, Ajit.
Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yeah. Now.
Okay. So radial head fracture, this is most common elbow fracture, around 33% of the fracture. This kind of injury happens because of the fall on outstretched hand. It has unique anatomy. It's not rounded. It's elliptical shape, and there's 15 degree of the neck offset. The radial head fracture is there. We should always see it as not only as a radial head fracture, we should always see it as an intramembrane injury and the distal joint. Because the injury happens to the radial head, it can transmit to the intraosseous membrane as well as the distal radioulnar joint also. So around 60% of the wrist load is transmitted to the radiocapitular joint through the radial head, and the more forces are to the radiocapitular joint in the pronation. So the load transfer from the wrist and the radial head is a kind of, you know, the valgus stabilizer, secondary valgus stabilizer. Hotchkiss has published one study, and it's a cadaveric study, where he has shows that if there's a F demonstrate a kind of valgus force, T demonstrate the amount of the stress over the medial collateral ligament, and R is the, you know, the fulcrum distance. So in normal elbow where there's a radial head is intact, and the force is transmitted through the MCL is normal. But whenever there is MCL ligament is torn, there is no force or there is no tension or the medial collateral ligament. But you just imagine if someone has the radial head excision, head is not there, whatever the force or the valgus force is transmitted, the stress over, I mean the tension or the medial collateral ligament complex is lot more than the normal, because the fulcrum distance is less. So the radial head is secondary stabilizer for the elbow. It's very important to understand the MCL anatomy there. Medial collateral ligament complex has three kind of bundles. There's anterior bundle, posterior bundle, and the transverse bundle. The anterior bundle is the prime stabilizer of the valgus force, and this is originated from the medial collateral ligament and inserting the and tubercle. So always examine the medial collateral ligament and see the check for the intraosseous ligament injuries, see the distal radioulnar joint and any kind of mechanical block or decrepitus during the range of movement. So radiography, the normal lateral and oblique views are important, and always see for the fat sign. This is the kind of hemorrhosis present in the elbow joint, and you will see the fat sign where the undisplaced structure. Don't forget to take the X-ray of the wrist joint, because if the intraosseous membrane injury is there, there must be the distal radioulnar joint also be affected. I always prefer to do the CT scan in almost every case. This is not mandatory, but I prefer to do the CT scan in all kind of the elbow injuries or the elbow fractures. Mazen has classified the radial head in three types. Type 1 is undisplaced, 2 is displaced, and 3 is displaced with the combinations. The Johnson has modified its classification and added type 4 where the elbow dislocation is present. So the Mason classification, the disadvantage of Mason classification is that this is not predicted for the surgical treatment, so that the Hotchkiss has came with the new classification, which has a predicted surgical outcome. So the type 1 where is the non-displaced, and these kind of, they are minimally displaced less than 2 millimeter with the marginal lip fractures. These kind of fractures, they generally don't require surgery. They can be easily managed with pouch. And the type 2 is displaced fracture, where is the more than 2 millimeter or the more the, and where the mechanical block is there. So these kind of fractures, they require surgical attention. And the type 2 terminated, where the fixation is not possible, and they require excision of the fragment or placement of the head. So type 1 Mason, these kind of fractures, they can be managed conservatively. Aspirate the joint and see the range of movement. Voice disturbance is there. Please mute all everyone's your... So these kind of fractures, they can be managed very well with the arm's length pouch, and they require kind of a slab or cast applications. But we have to keep eye on this, and we should check X-rays on every week so that if any kind of displacement happens, we can identify. So they have wonderful results. The 21-year follow-up, the full range of movements, around 10% of the mild occasional pain, there's no objective impairment and the no osteoarthritis. But consider surgery if it is associated with the lesions. So type 1 fractures along with... I'm so sorry that some others one has a speaking. So consider surgery if it is associated with lesion. Associated lesions means if someone has a capitulum fracture, or there's someone has trochlear fracture, coronoid fracture, or there's elbow dislocation is there, or the patient has ligamentous injuries there. So these kind of lesions associated with the type 1 fractures, surgical intervention may request. Type 2 fracture, where the patient has more than 2 millimeter of displacement, or the more than one third of the radial head. As I have told that the CT scan is important because sometimes it may be associated with other lesions also. So the treatment is controversial. We should go for the, there's literature which is supporting non-operative management, and there are literature who is supporting open reduction, internal fixation, and the fragment excision or the radial head excision. So this is a very senior anesthetist of the Kanpur who has a fracture of the type 1 fracture of the radial head. You can see there's a fracture of the radial head along with the capitulum fracture. So I did open reduction and the headless compression screw fixation. And this is the follow-up after 2 years. He has almost full flexion extension and almost full pronation and supination. So it's almost two and a half years after the surgery. So the result is good to excellent in 93% of the patient, range of movement 10 to 130 degree. So advantage of fixation is the preservation of the articular surface. We have radial plates available to fix the radial head fractures. There are two kinds of plates, rim plate and neck plate. Rim plate is used basically when there is a fracture of the head as well as the neck fractures there, while the neck plate is used, they are the low profile. They can be applied. So for the fixation, there is something called the safe zone. So what is safe zone? Safe zone is basically the non-articular part of the radial head where you can put your implant and they will not create any kind of hindrance in the pronation and supination. So this safe zone is in mid-prone position, or you can say the neutral position, 2 to 4 o'clock position is the safe zone. But you know that the new concept has came that which says that the putting the plate is not good. It should be always low profile fixation. I mean that you can put 2 screws which can fix from head and neck also. Better than putting the plates, because you know that if you'll see the anatomy, there's the radial recurrent artery, which is which gives blood supply to the radial head, it pierces to the radial neck exactly at the safe zone area. I think you are getting my point. The safe zone area is the place from where the radial recurrent artery pierces. And if you are going to put plate on this area, where in the safe zone, probably will jeopardize the vascularity of the radial head. That's why the new concept says that the radial plate fixation should be discouraged, or we should not put the radial head plate. Rather than putting the headless compression screws, 2 or multiple headless compression screws, which fix the head as well as the neck also. This is a patient who has a type 2 fracture. There is a displaced, if you'll see the CT scan, there is a fracture, displaced fracture, radial head fracture along with the neck fracture. You know, there's a articular cartilage has been also be able. So I've used the T-bone to suture that and fix with the plate. And this is a result after around 2 years of the fixation, almost full flexion, full extension, and good pronation and supination. So this injury has happened. It was happened, you know, that around 2.5 years, and now is doing well. So the indication of putting the plate, because this he has a multiple displaced fracture along with the neck fracture. So the treatment, I think this chart is very important to understand that when, where, how, and what we should put. So if it is less than what the David Ring has published a paper in 2005, I think in JBJS, which says that if the more than three fragment, we should go for the excision, and the more less than three fragment, we should go for the fixation. So if you'll see that the three fragment, if there's less than three fragment, we should go for the ORAF. If it is more than three fragment, we should always check. Before going excision, we should always check medial collateral ligament, LCL, intraosseous membrane, and associated injury. If it is there, take out the radial head and replace it. If it is not there, patient is low demanding, you can go for the radial head excision. But if patient is high demanding, and along with the medial, these associated lesions, more than three fragment of the radial head, we should, no doubt, we should always go for the radial head replacement. So as I've told that the ring has, David Ring has published and shows that more than three fragment, poor result of fixation, and the radial head replacement is indicated. While the current practice is that is a stable fixation is still possible, we should go for the open reduction and internal fixation. So if not able to fix to or restore the articular surface, what we should do? I mean, the type three and type four where resection or replacement is needed. So avoid dissection if there is any question of instability, Essex Lopresti lesion, Montegia lesion, coronoid fracture. But the resection outcome of the resection is 90% of satisfactory at the 25 years. So radial head replacement, it's non when there is non-reconstructable, resect the radial head. But few things is very important to understand before going for the radial head replacement. Check for the valgus stress test. So what is valgus stress test? Give a valgus force to the elbow and see the opening of at the medial side of the joint. So if you give the valgus stress and there's an opening of the medial side of the joint, it means that the MCL complex has been torn. So you should go for the replacement. Another thing is that the radius pull test. So radius pull test is basically use a Cocker forceps and pull the radius and see the how much of the play is there. And you can see in the check, you can check the image intensifier that the how much distal radial joint is distracted. If it is distraction is more than 2 millimeter, it means this patient has intraosseous membrane injury and you should go for the radial head replacement. So the important thing when we are deciding that we are going for the radial head replacement, how to put, I mean that what should be the size, because the size is very important for the radial head. If radial head is you know that if it is ideally the radial head should be at the proximal margin of the lesser sigma notch. The head should be at the proximal margin of the lesser sigma notch. So this is the ideal condition where this is the ideal place where the radial head should be. If it is more than that, I mean that if the prosthesis is longer, it will have the, you know, that the impingement or the capitulum that will lead to the persistent pain to the patients. So it's better to put, you know, that it's better to put exact size. If it is not possible, lesser size is better than the putting the larger size. So if there's a study, this cadaveric study, which shows that you see that the if size of the prosthesis is increasing, so this is a normal size, if 2 plus 2 millimeter plus 4 millimeter plus 6 and plus 8 millimeter, see the how the opening of how much opening happens over the ulno humeral joint. This is a 40-year-old lady, has multiple fragment, more than three fragment and displaced, and along with the fracture of the neck. So I have operated this patient and did the replacement. And this is a, you know, that the prosthesis is below the line of proximal margin of the lesser sigma notch. And this is the result of after 1.5 year, which has, there is some flexion, you know, it's not complete, full extension is not there, full flexion is there, but pronation, supination is good. So C has good pronation and supination. So we should, as I told that, we should keep in mind that the associated injuries and you know that if the type one, this literature which says that the type one fractures around 0% of associated injuries, while the type three injuries have more, had 91% of the injuries. So there's very interesting paper which is published in about the Essex Lopresti syndrome, where the distal radial ulnar joint dissociation. In 15 of 20 patients, the wrist injuries was diagnosed after a mean delay of almost 8 years. all 15 patients were treated with radial head excision, and all patients complained of the severe pain at distal radial nerve joint. So now you understand the importance of the intraosseous membrane before going for the radial head excision. So I just want to conclude that identify the associated injuries. This is the most important thing. And whenever the elbow injuries happens, go and please do the CT scan. Without CT scan, I think this is not a good idea to operate. Type 1 fracture can be easily managed with the non-operative treatment. Type 2 and type 3, there's various recommendations which Hodgkin's are likely changing. Many type 2 will do well with the non-operative treatment. Role of open reduction, internal fixation, arthroplasty, and excision is not clearly defined. Thank you so much. So I think our next talk.
Thank you, Ajit. A very well illustrated lecture on the radial head fractures. You have covered all the parts of the radial head fractures. Now I would invite to Dr. Abhijit for the next lecture on elbow instability. Dr. Abhijit.
Yeah, Ajit.
I'm trying to find out my button.
Share screen.
Stop share screen.
Stop sharing.
It's at the bottom. So while Ajit is unsharing his screen, I have a small disclaimer. Actually, Ram Chidambaram was to speak only on coronoid fractures, and I think he covered the entire elbow instability talk. So my talk was supposed to be on elbow instability, and pretty much of what I was supposed to talk was covered by Ram. So what I did was, I didn't unfortunately pay attention to your talk, Ajit. I was putting together a talk on coronoid fractures. So with the permission of the chair, permission of the UPOA and the KOA, please indulge me as I talk about coronoid fractures, which I put together in the last 20 minutes. So,
oh my God, you have changed topic. You're brilliant, absolutely.
No. It was, otherwise it would have been very repetitive. I fortunately had this talk from a very recent lecture to our residents. So,
but you will not escape from the questions. You don't.
Not a problem. Leave you. I hope I'll be able to answer them. So good afternoon, gentlemen, and thank you very much to the Kanpur Orthopedic Association, the UPOA, and the Regency Hospital, especially Ajit Tiwari, for putting this webinar together. And it is my distinct honor to be a part of this webinar. And more than speaking here, I am learning so much from you all. And anything that has to do with Kanpur Orthopedic Association and my peers and my friends from Kanpur, it is always a joy to be back, although virtually for this webinar now. So without further ado, I do not have any disclosures related to this particular talk, and coronoid fractures, I'm sure, poses such a big diagnostic as well as a therapeutic dilemma in a clinical practice. At whatever stage of practice you are, even the most senior orthopedic surgeons and trauma specialists are always vexed by these fractures because they can be so difficult to treat, and they pose a very, very difficult dilemma. So what is the problem with coronoid fractures? Most of the times, as you have seen in the previous talks, they are very subtle fractures. You know, you'll see just a fracture of the tip of the coronoid. It may be comminuted. Sometimes it may be so innocuous looking that you may think that this can be just left well alone, only to realize a late instability that may result from having neglected this fracture, either missing the diagnosis or neglecting it in treatment. And we should recognize that fracture subluxation. So this is the initial part of the instability pattern that Ram showed, when there is a force that travels around the elbow. This is called as a circle of Hori, H-O-R-I-I. He was a Japanese orthopedic surgeon who described the instability patterns that result from a fall onto an outstretched hand. So the circle of Hori will lead to initial subtle instability in the form of subluxation, which leads to an incongruity and progressive degeneration. So there is something called as a river delta sign. This nice curve here that you see should be recognized, and it is equidistant throughout. So if you look at any aspect of the ulnohumeral joint on the anteroposterior X-ray, you will see that there is equidistant and a very nice smooth curve like a wave. So this is called as a river delta sign. So in this particular injury pattern, it doesn't take rocket science to know that the elbow is very unstable. It is completely dislocated, and I'm sure everyone will agree that there is everything around the elbow must be torn. It is the subtle instability. Now look at this particular X-ray here. You will realize that the space here is narrowed as compared to the space here. And that is where we need to be very careful and pay attention to these subtle instability signs to recognize any problems that are going on with a very innocuous type 1 coronoid fracture. So Regan and Morey classified and published classification of coronoid fractures in 1989, and they classified it as type 1 and 2 and 3, which is highlighted in this particular slide. And this is based on a lateral radiograph. What we saw previously was based on an anteroposterior radiograph. We look at instability. So when you look at the true lateral view, you would see a fracture of the coronoid, and depending upon how much percentage of surface of the coronoid is involved, you would classify it as 1, 2, and 3. So O'Driscoll again classified coronoid fractures, giving a very kind of a comprehensive classification. The tip fractures, which are akin to the Regan and Morey type 1, was classified into subtype 1 and 2. Subtype 1 is a flake fracture, which is less than 2 millimeters of coronoid. But you should note that all of these are instability, are associated with an instability to a greater or lesser extent. Subtype 2 is when this is more than 2 millimeters of the coronoid height. Then he classified it as anteromedial involvement of the coronoid, where there are three subtypes. There is an anteromedial rim, there is an anteromedial rim and a tip, and there is a fracture of the sublime tubercle and the tip, and along with the anteromedial rim in subtype 3. And then the third classification is of basal fractures, where the entire coronoid body and the base is involved. These are very severe shear fractures. And then subtype 2 is transolecranon basal coronoid fractures that was shown in Ram's case, where you go through the coronoid fracture and then you catch through the olecranon fracture, you catch the coronoid fragment and you fix it. So this is a schematic diagram that was that is based on O'Driscoll's classification, and it is usually based on a 3D CT construct. You can see type 1 fractures are those here. Type 2 fractures are involving this particular fragment here. Type 3 fractures will be the anteromedial facet, and type 4 will involve the entire coronoid, all right? So you can see from this particular slide that the commonest presentation is that of the tip fractures, the flake fractures or just the tip fractures. Now, anterolateral coronoid fractures, let us talk about them. Those are the fractures that we are looking at. And what are the patterns? So the type 1 tip fractures is shown in the schematic diagram. These fractures are usually associated with a posterolateral rotatory instability. There is an injury to the lateral ulnar collateral ligament. There is usually a fracture of the radial head. Like I said, there is a tip fracture of the coronoid, and perhaps at times you may also come across a medial collateral ligament injury. Now, this is extremely important to understand and recognize, because if you are thinking of doing a radial head excision, if it is severely comminuted and the medial hinge is compromised, this forms a contraindication for excision of the radial head. So this is something that you have to recognize and you have to address. So what to repair in these particular injuries? So tip fractures, it is essentially an elbow dislocation and treat as such. The coronoid trip is often not repairable because it is very, very small. And for these cases, it is always, always mandatory to examine under anesthesia under fluoroscopy live. This is very helpful. Understand that most of the subtle instabilities and the dislocations of elbow are dynamic instabilities, and they have to be addressed with examination under anesthesia rather than a clinical examination, solely relying on a clinical examination in the clinic. So we usually, what we do is we can use these pull-out sutures through the ulna, and then either you can use an endo button or you can just tie it subcutaneously. So we use sutures through the capsular attachment of the coronoid process for these type 1 fractures, or sometimes involving a little larger fragment, which are not fixable with implants, or you may not be able to put an anti-glide plate around here. So these are addressed in this particular manner. If you're going through the lateral aspect, you may want to use an ACL guide as a pointing device to get your hole correctly. But if you're going from the medial side, we'll just come to that as to how we approach the coronoid tip. We usually use non-absorbable braided sutures, such as the fiber wire from Arthrex. I do not have any financial conflict of interest. And these fractures can be addressed either from the medial or the lateral side. We prefer to use the medial side because a very good approach and a very good exposure can be obtained from the medial side. However, if there is a radial head fracture, you can use it to your advantage and you can work through the defect to repair the coronoid from the lateral side before you fix the radial head. So here you can see a radial head fracture and that has been retracted, and then you can approach the tip from the lateral side and you can do the same procedure. You can see the pull-out sutures here coming out from the ulna on the posterior aspect to be tied out there. So tip fractures such as these, which are very small, you can use a pointing device such as an ACL guide. And again, you can get your sutures out to pull the fragment down onto the coronoid base. This is perhaps a better technique because when you use suture anchors, you're tying on top of the capsule or tying on top of the coronoid fragment. However, if you do a pull-out suture, you're able to pull the entire capsule and the soft tissue attachment down to the base, and that gives you a very solid repair. Let us now talk about the second subset, which are anteromedial fractures. So this we already talked about anterolateral tip fractures here. Now we will talk about the anteromedial fractures. Again, these are pretty common fractures and are associated with severe instability. And these are associated with posteromedial rotatory instability. Now, this is completely different from posterolateral rotatory instability. What is involved in this pattern is a avulsion of the lateral and the collateral ligament. There is a fracture of the anteromedial coronoid. And in these cases, almost always, there is a rupture of the medial collateral ligament, with majority of the cases having an involvement of the anterior band of the medial collateral. The medial collateral ligament is intact, the anterior band is intact, and the other two bundles are torn. So what do we fix in these particular injuries? We prefer to use a posterior approach. On the medial side, you fix the medial coronoid through the floor of the ulnar nerve. You can do an open reduction internal fixation of the coronoid with a plate or an ACL guide with cannulated screws. And on the lateral side, you repair the lateral and the collateral ligament. Here is a case in point where there is a varus posterior medial instability because of an involvement of the coronoid. And we have used a plate here to fix the fracture fragment and repair the ligaments on both sides to achieve stability of the elbow joint. So this is a cadaver video of how we approach. So this is this is proximal and this is distal here, that is the ulnar nerve. So we go through the floor of the ulnar nerve, that is a branch to the FCU that you just saw, and you lift the muscles, the flexor pronator mass of the, I'm just going to escape the PowerPoint presentation here so that, yeah, there you go. And then once you reflect the entire flexor pronator mass of the sublime tubercle, that is a sublime tubercle here, and you can come across the coronoid here, that is a medial condyle here, and that is a coronoid out there, right? And that is how you would approach the coronoid from the medial or the posterior aspect. So again, this is an anterior medial coronoid fracture. What did we find at surgery? There was a fracture with a medial collateral ligament avulsion. There was a type 3 radiolate fracture, and an LCL avulsion was expected, and that was also found. What did we do? From the medial side, we repaired the coronoid fracture. We did a reconstruction of the MCL with a tendon graft to augment because it was very tattered. We did a radial head replacement and repaired the LCL to accomplish stability. The anterolateral fracture, again, this is a an example in a 59-year-old female who had a fall, low-velocity injury. You can see on the CT scan with the 3D reconstruction, the fracture fragment pattern. There was a fracture of the coronoid, which was fixed with a cannulated screw on the lateral side. We did a radial head replacement with repair of the LCL and a reefing of the extensor origin. And on the medial side, a medial collateral ligament repair with transosseous suture wires was done. That is the post-operative follow-up at 2 years. Now we'll talk about basal fractures, which involves the entire fragment of the coronoid here, involving a part of the sigmoid notch. And that is usually from a very high velocity trauma. This is the point in case where the repair and reconstruction was done. This is something which is very difficult. Most of the basal fractures will be a result of a trans-olecranon fracture dislocation, but we can use this defect or this injury to our advantage to approach the coronoid through the fracture, through the olecranon fracture. And this is usually a posterior approach where we address the coronoid fracture and then you fix the coronoid with an anticlide plate or through plates and screws for the olecranon itself. And if you can address this through the plate itself, it is a very good way to do it. However, there is a caveat to this that we'll talk in a little while. So posterior incision is taken and the coronoid fracture is fixed with cannulated screws through the olecranon fracture. You can fix the radial head fracture, the medial collateral ligament, if it is intact, it was intact in this particular case. Olecranon fracture was reduced and fixed with plate and screws, and an LCL avulsion was repaired. And that is the post-operative picture to show what we did. So here is another case of a trans-olecranon fracture. The radial head is intact in this particular injury, but the basal fragment of the coronoid can be seen very clearly out here. And that is something that you can address through the olecranon fracture. And you can then fix with suture, that is a pullout kind of a suture, and the LCL was repaired with anchors. What are the newer techniques for coronoid fracture fixation? This is a paper that was published by Steinman. It is now a very reliable technique, is used by advanced arthroscopists, where they do an arthroscopic debridement of very small fractures of the coronoid, and then they do an LCL, so fractures such as this, which are not repairable, and then they do imbrication of the LUCL with sutures such as this. We are very early in our experience with arthroscopic LUCL repair, but hopefully we'll be able to present our results very shortly. So there is new data to suggest that coronoid fracture outcomes can be treated appropriately with good outcomes if these fractures are identified and addressed in an appropriate manner. This is data from a study by Dr. Morey, and they concluded that patients who had a plate fixation had significantly higher pain and less motion than those with fracture excision and repair of the capsule and the soft tissues. But they also had more severe fractures, these subset of patients. So more often than not, coronoid fractures are usually associated with fractures of other bones and ligaments in the elbow. That is something that we need to recognize and understand. There are certain pitfalls. You should always be very, very careful and keep an eye for subtle coronoid fractures that we talked about. We talked about the caveat of dealing with trans olecranon coronoid fractures. What you should not do in this is fall short of fixation. So in this particular case, this screw was used through the plate to fix the fracture, whereas the fracture is somewhere here. So we completely missed that particular injury, and you can see that there is a late instability and the entire elbow is falling apart. At times, you may have to resort to external fixators when there is a very severe instability that is associated with comminuted fractures. In these particular cases, you should reduce and secure all bony and ligamentous injuries and then use a fixator, whether it is a hinge or a static fixator, depends upon the availability, but it is advisable to use the hinge, and the hinge is through the center of rotation of the elbow, and this will neutralize the varus gravitational forces and early mobilization can be started. So in summary, do not misidentify an anterior medial fracture with a tip fracture, which is the basis, the fundamental basis between posterior medial and posterior lateral rotator instability. Elbow dislocation where there is no radial fracture, you should look closely at the coronoid. And the most common complication following a missed coronoid fracture is instability and stiffness, and that should be identified and addressed to prevent any complications. So with that, I would like to thank you. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to take any questions. Thank you very much. I'll just stop sharing my screen, and there you go.
Thank you, Dr. Abhijit, for an excellent talk on the elbow stability. My question is, what is the post-op protocol in the terrible triad treatment after the management of terrible triad or posterolateral instability, usually? What are the post-op protocol?
Good question. So in case we are not using a hinge elbow fixator, we never ask the patient to work in the frontal plane like so. So the physiotherapy shouldn't be done like this, but against the torso, so as to eliminate any stress on the lateral and collateral repair or reconstruction that you've done. That's usually up to about 2 to 3 months. We begin therapy at around 3 to 4 weeks, gentle range of motion exercises, like I said, not in the frontal plane, but more so against the torso. However, if you're using a hinge elbow fixator, you may start elbow range of movement, and then that could also be done in the frontal plane. We like to immobilize the patient for about 3 weeks until such time that the edema and the swelling has subsided and the patient is comfortable. And then we begin with active and passive range of motion exercises. One very important caveat that I would like to share with you all is that we very systematically, if we have to go medial, we always transpose the ulnar nerve. We have to understand that. So there is very compelling evidence from Sean O'Driscoll and I think Oaklander from Johns Hopkins that one of the most important reasons why stiffness occurs is because of ulnar nerve irritation and compression. So whatever edema, whatever hematoma is there, that's going to resolve and that is going to lead to ulnar nerve irritation and compression. So we not only decompress, but we also transpose the nerve, because stiffness is one form of a CRPS, if you will. So that is something that we do systematically. But there are a lot of authors, a lot of surgeons who just do a decompression of the ulnar nerve.
Dr. Abhijit.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Abhijit, excellent talk. I wanted to know whether the CT or MRI is fruitful for this.
Good question, sir. So if you have to get an MRI done, an MRI immediately after.
Ajit, you have to keep the participants in mute, otherwise it's going to
be. Yeah, please keep everyone on mute. May I just share my screen for one very brief moment, if you will indulge me, please?
Yes, go ahead.
So this was supposed to be my talk on elbow instability. And this is a surgery that was done after 2 days of surgery. This is a surgery that was done about 3 weeks after the injury. You can see that the planes are very well visible, everything, the edema has subsided. This was a surgery that we did on the third day after the injury. And can you appreciate all that hematoma, all that edema, that's the ulnar nerve, that is the condyle, that is the olecranon, that is the coronoid. So it's so difficult to see the planes, the tissues from a fresh injury. So the point I'm trying to make is if you get an MRI done immediately after injury, all that hematoma is going to just look white on your T2 images. So it is always advisable to wait for a little while and then get an MRI done for ligament injuries. However, if there are fractures, especially the subtle fractures, I think a CT scan is absolutely invaluable. What we do in our practice is we wait for about 10 days or so till the edema is reduced. At that time, we get a CT scan and a combined MRI, limited cuts. And once we have that, we embark on surgery roughly at around 2 weeks after the injury. I hope that helps.
One question to Dr. Ajit by Dr. Manish Trivedi. What is the immobilization duration in case of radial head excision?
So the immobilization for the radial head excision is basically just for the 2 weeks, just for the soft tissue healing. And once the soft tissue healing has been done, you can start mobilization early. There's no need to put cast for the 1 month or something like that. It's an early mobilization where you can start, just wait for the soft tissue healing only. I think Dr. Anupam has asked question to me that how to measure the size of the radial head. So actually the radial head, the prosthesis, is exactly it's a round shape. I mean that if you'll see the head of the radial radius head, it is elliptical. I think this is the disadvantage of the prosthesis, that is it exactly doesn't match like an elliptical shape. There's a measuring guide for the head, radial head. You can measure, if there's multiple pieces, you just pin them and the join together and make one piece and just measure with the measuring guide and think that appropriate.
So why would you excise a radial head in the primary in a fresh situation? Avoid doing an excision in the initial phase, and if you have to do it later rather than initially.
So if the size, as David Ring has published, if it is more than 3 fragments, sometimes it is difficult to fix all those fractures together. So what will happen that if they will not be fixed properly, then they will start, that the getting of difficulty in the movement, because that loose fragment will keep difficulty in pronation and supination. So either we should replace it or we should fix them. We cannot leave the fragment as such there. So it's quite comminuted, it's very difficult to hold them together and fix them. So in that scenario, we should take it out. And if interosseous membrane injury is there, associated lesion is there, we should go for the replacement. But
I've seen patients who dislocated the elbow after a early radial head excision, which was not dislocated earlier. Okay. So I think something you really be very careful about.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
Can I make a point? So I think that's a very important. Yeah. That's exactly what I mentioned in my talk. You have to be absolutely sure that the medial hinge is intact.
It's absolutely intact. I agree.
Yeah. And if the medial hinge is compromised, when I say compromised, it need not be a complete rupture, but even a stretching injury is an absolute contraindication for removal or excision of the radial head. And that is something that we need to identify. Otherwise, there is going to be a big problem. I think Vikas Gupta, sir, wants to say
something.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We have access to various kinds of radial head processes. But for people who don't have access to processes, they can assemble on table, fix on table, then they put it back. That is a much better option than excising it and making the elbow unstable. Fix it on table, then put it back as a fracture neck radius and fix it with a multiple screws, and it's a much better option than just excising it.
Yeah, in fact, there's a one nice paper that which says that this, if there's a, you cannot fix the radial head, take a bone cement, make it like a radial head, and put the plate and fix with the, you know, the radius, and that
basically like need a spacer.
Yes. Abhijit sir is saying something.
Yeah, so the idea is that till such time that the soft tissue sleeve has healed and has becomes robust, especially when there's a medial collateral ligament injury.
To Abhijit. Yeah, we lost Abhijit sir. Abhijit sir?
I think the connection.
Yeah.
These tricks to tie sir, over sir,
the we have Vamsi with us. Vamsi, are you getting us? Abhijit sir, unmute yourself.
Ajit, I can hear you.
Yes, yeah. Vamsi, what's your thought about radial head resection and the replacement?
I think if the isolated radial head, I think you should, one option is, I think you should be ready to fix it or replace it. If by chance, you know, you're not confident that you can't fix it or replace it, what I suggest is wait for three or four weeks. Let the medial collateral ligaments, lateral collateral ligaments scar down and heal. Then you go and do the radial head so that there'll be no issue of ligament instability or redislocation. This is my view. But since I have access to plates and head, I would either do one of these. Not excise.
Okay. Abhijit sir, you are saying something?
No, that's exactly the point. And also, it's not only the medial collateral ligament, about 20 to 30% of radial head fractures will also have an associated LUCL injury. So you need to, kind of bear that in mind when you embark upon treatment for radial head fractures.
So I have one question to all the panelists, that what's your opinion about, if there's a fracture of the radial head as well as the neck fracture is there, should we go for the plate fixation, as you know that there's concept that the vascularity of the radial head comes from the neck, and if there's a neck fracture, that radial head is not going to survive. So what's your opinion in that scenario? Should we go for the replacement, or we should fix the radial head with the plate?
I think Vikash wants to answer that. I think unmute yourself, Vikash. Vikash, you need to unmute yourself.
Vikas, unmute yourself.
See, yes. I'll say the vascularity, your very good slide you were showing about the vascularity, but whenever there's a fracture, the disruption of soft tissue is there. And most of the radial head fractures, especially comminuted ones, it is the profile of the plate which doesn't allow it to rotate smoothly over in the soft tissues. There's a lot of fibrosis around the plate. We have removed quite a few plates and we found that there was a lot of fibrosis around the plate, which is causing restriction in the pronation supination. So we are not using those locking radial head plate. We either use a compact hand plate, 2 mm locking plate, or we are using multiple screws. And these things, low profile implants, are giving us better, you can say, better results compared to that high profile proximal or radial head plate. John, do you have any comments about it? John, you have to unmute yourself.
Just doing it. In the last couple of years, I've very rarely used the pre-contoured radial head plate that synthesis, because they are too bulky and they cause problems. So I tend to go more with multiple screw fixations. And if I have to use a plate, I try to use one of those very thin plates, either from the radial, distal radial fracture, the LDRS set or something like that, which is just the thinner ones, which is for the styloid, etc., or from the hand set. So I try to avoid using plates on the radial side as much as possible nowadays.
So one question to Abhijit, sir. Sir, in case of the elbow dislocation, where it's just, that the coronary tip fracture is there, or there's no fracture at all, but the elbow is dislocated, how to proceed? Should we go? Yeah.
So I think first and foremost, an examination under anesthesia is of paramount importance before you even plan your incisions. you look for the pivot shift test, you look for the lateral, the varus and valgus stress test, as well as the posterior and medial rotatory instability test. That'll give you pretty much an idea as to which ligaments are involved and what is the direction of the instability. In case you have, so the commonest is of course a lateral and a collateral ligament injury, your approach is straightforward. And then you, more often than not, the ligament is avulsed from the humeral attachment, and then you can use all these suture anchors and these, the internal bracing methods that are recently available to reconstitute repair. If it is a chronic injury, that is to say a chronic posterior lateral rotator instability, where you have to use a free tendon graft that may be augmented with a suture tape and again, an internal bracing kind of a technique to accomplish very good stability. If it is a pure medial collateral ligament injury, which is very rare, you look, of course, at the range of movement. Can I share my screen one more time again, if you won't mind, if you'll indulge?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Because rather than speaking too much, I would like to just show an algorithm that will help you understand what we need to do for. So this is the algorithm for acute instability or acute dislocation. So you reduce under anesthesia, you test for stability in a range of movement from 0 to 145 degrees. If it is stable, you would immobilize until pain relief and then you start early mobilization. If it is unstable in this range of movement, you examine the stability with the forearm in pronation. If the elbow is stable, you use a hinge elbow brace, keep the forearm in pronation, and then you mobilize at an appropriate time. If the elbow is stable after 30 degrees of flexion, that is to say at 30 degrees of flexion and extension beyond that it is dislocating, you again use a hinge elbow brace with 30 degrees of extension block with the forearm in pronation, and you maintain that till soft tissue healing is obtained, and then you begin mobilization. If the elbow is stable after 60 degrees of flexion, so this is an increasing grade of instability, you use a hinge elbow brace with 60 degrees of extension block with the forearm in neutral. And if it is very unstable, you do an ligament repair with an external fixator. For chronic instability, you look at the intact humeral ulnar joint. If it is not intact, if osteosynthesis is possible, you do it, look at elbow stability, and usually no ligament repair is required. However, it is unstable after your fixation, you would use a fixator. If the joint is intact, you evaluate other structures for stability. If the radial head is intact, the elbow is stable, and then you mobilize. If it is unstable, you do a ligament repair. If the radial head is fractured and osteosynthesis is possible, you go ahead and fix, and then you come back to this algorithm. If it is not possible to fix it and the elbow is unstable, you kind of go in for a radial head replacement and look for stability. And if synthesis is possible, you kind of do a fixation and look for stability. I hope that helps. It's a little confusing, but it's published in literature and you can refer to it. Thank you.
So there's one question for Abhijit sir to you that how to identify the medial deficit on the X-ray? Dr. Nirbhay is asking how to identify medial deficit on X-ray. Is it possible?
Yeah, you can do a valgus stress test. In about 20 to 30 degrees of elbow flexion and look for opening out.
Okay, so
it meant medial instability.
Medial instability. And if it is a chronic medial instability, so this is called as a valgus hyperextension overload injury, you start seeing these degenerative changes in the olecranon and the posterior aspect of the olecranon and the humerus as a very early subtle sign. So at the tip of the olecranon, you will start seeing osteophytes. You'll start seeing osteophytes at the humero-ulnar articulation posteriorly. So that is all. So this is usually seen in throwing athletes, such as baseball pitchers, javelin throwers. So because of the constant valgus extension overload, there is an insufficiency of the medial collateral.
Okay, so there's one question Dr. Unmesh is asking, how much of angulation for the neck of radius would be accepted in right or left elbow? Abhijit, sir, you want to take this question? Other panelists, anyone?
Someone can answer. Vikas Gupta, sir, please.
Vikas, sir?
I think if it is pediatric, then acceptance is more adults. The acceptance is very less because in adults there is no remodeling. I think John is going to take care of this talk. Like, okay. John,
because I'm not covering everything in as it is, it's big enough. Okay. So I think 45 degrees is about angulation. If you accept in a acute injury for the radial neck. Okay, so for a radial neck up to 40, 45 degrees, you would accept it and not and treat them conservatively. If it is more than that, you need to try and reduce and fix it. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Last question. Dr. Anupam is asking that to fix the plate on mid prone position. So actually, basically, I always put a plate in the supine position when the forearm is fully pronated. What about other panelists? How they fix?
Yeah, so the position of the plate, there's one more study which says that you put in the area which correlates between the area between the Lister's tubercle and radial stellar process. The plate stem has to be in that position. You got it? It's okay. The area, the safe zone. One method is the way you described. Other method is it has to be between the Lister's tubercle of the radius and the radial stellar process. That is supposed to be the non-articulating zone of the radius.
Okay. I think he's asking about the positioning of the patient.
Oh, you mean position of the patient? Sorry. Okay.
Yes. He's asking about
on a side table. Maybe you can give a pillow over the middle aspect of the arm and go through the caucus approach.
Okay. I think we have done with the questions. We'll move for the next session. Dr. Lamba sir is there. Lamba sir, are you listening us?
Yes.
So please proceed, sir. Next session.
I welcome everyone and good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
We start our third session today and I invite Dr. Vikas Gupta from Max Hospital. He is the director of the hand and shoulder injury and I invite him to please talk on the Montegia fracture and its variant. Dr. Vikas.
Thank you, Dr. Lamba. Before we start, I thank Dr. Ajit and UPA for giving this opportunity. We'll be talking about Montegia fracture in adults. I'll cover some part of classification of pediatric group. So these are the two fractures. You can see fracture of the ulna, oblique fracture ulna, short oblique fracture ulna. They appear when you're focusing on fracture, they look similar, but you look at the X-ray as a whole, they are completely different. Left side, you can, there is a radial head which is dislocated anteriorly, and on the right side, it is only ulna fracture, isolated ulna fracture. So both have to be managed separately. The extent of injury is more on the left X-ray because soft tissue damage, interosseous membrane damage, annular ligament. These are the structures which are damaged before radial head gets dislocated. So annular ligament, interosseous membrane, ligament, they are damaged before radial head gets dislocated. When we see the history, Montegia described this kind of an injury, proximal ulna fracture with the radial head dislocation in 1814, before X-rays were discovered. But after more than 150 years later, in 1967, Bardo coined the term Montegia lesion and classified these injury into four types. We'll be discussing this after this slide. So what happens? Montegia fracture dislocation, there's a fracture proximal ulna, dislocation of the radial head. It is more common in children. More commonest mechanism of injury is fall on outstretched hand, either in hyperpronation or in hyperextension. Chief complaints are pain, swelling, deformity, and loss of rotations. Investigations, mostly we do X-ray epilateral, which is sufficient to diagnose. But many times complex fractures, we need CT scan to plan the surgery. So according to Bardo classification, type 1 injury is a commonest. 60% of these, 60% of Montegia lesions, they come under this, in which there's anterior angulation with an anterior dislocation of the radial head. Type 2 injuries, which are posterior dislocation, which are 5% of the lesions, very uncommon, but adults, it is more common. It is the commonest fracture in adults. Type 3, there's a lateral dislocation of the head. These injuries are more common with the posterior interosseous injuries. And type 4 injuries are when there's a fracture of radius and ulna along with the radial head dislocation. Again, this is a much rarer type of injury. So just examples of few. Type 1, there's an anterior dislocation, radial head. Type 2, apex is posterior, dislocation is posterior. Type 3 is a lateral one. And type 4 is a combined injury. So these are the examples. But Jupiter classified these lesions into four subtypes. So Jupiter subclassification, which was published in 1991. Type 2A had a very proximal ulna fracture, which include coronoid. So as we see, coronoid is a very important part in the elbow. Dr. Ram, Dr. Abhijit, some part of Ajit has talked about it. And whatever remain, I'll be talking about coronoid fractures. So it is type 2A fractures, which are described by Jupiter. Second part of subclassification was 2B, in which the fractures were distal to the coronoid fracture, coronoid process at the junction between ulna metaphysis and the diaphysis. Type 2C were ulna diaphysis. Type 2D were complex ulna fracture, which extended from the olecranon to the diaphysis. So it's a very complicated, unstable type of a fracture. So clinical symptoms, we have already discussed. And just this, I'll cover this part. Type 1, you do a close reduction. If it fails, you do the open reduction of ulna, close reduction of radial head. If that fails, you open reduction of ulna with open reduction of radius. Idea is to get the good reduction of the ulna, good reduction of the radial head, because subluxated or dislocated radial head will have long-term effects on the growth of the radius. Type 2, again, close reduction is tried first. If close reduction fails, go for open reduction. Same thing in type 3. Type 4, you go for the try to do close reduction, but if it fails, open reduction with the plate or screws is advised. But in adults, all types of fracture, the treatment plan remains same. Open reduction, internal fixation of the ulna with plate and screws or rigid fixation. Close reduction of radial head. If it fails, you do open reduction, radial head, and the internal fixation of the ulna. If fracture is old, then you have to either go for a radial head excision or replacement. That depends on how the fracture is according to chronicity. So this is a commonest type. You fix the ulna, reduce the radial head, and mobilize the patient. So these are Mortiger again, and 1998 second publication by the Jesse Jupiter and David Ring, Mortiger fractures in adult, in which they had already subclassified in 1992. So the conclusion of this paper was that challenging injuries were where when there is a coronoid fracture or radial head fracture, the results were not as good as when there's only dislocation. That was the conclusion of this paper. Again, another paper from 2009. This says outcomes of Mortiger fracture in children are much better compared to the adults. And it said that if there's a type 3 fracture, posterior interosseous nerve injury is very common. Again, another paper coming from Brangi in 2012, in which they found that commonest injury Mortiger is type 1, type 2 is commonest injury in the adults. Type 3 is more associated with posterior interosseous injury, and most type of injury was of border type was type 4. So injury like this, segment fracture, which was segmental fracture of ulna with radial head, reduce the ulna and do the reduction of fixation or reduce the radial head, do the fixation of the ulna. Here you're lucky if you get a good result, but most of the time we try to get a rigid fixation with the plate. So this was again type 2A fracture in which coronoid and proximal ulna is fractured. It's a transolecranon type of a radial head dislocation, type 2A, Jupiter type 2A. This we did in around 2002 or 2003. I think 2003 when locking plates came into the V. So this was fixed. The coronet was fixed with the help of the screws, and it was allow us fixed with the help of plate. Good function. Very happy, but plate failed. Plate failed because of the biomechanics. Here we can see that there was comminuted fracture, and we had too many screws in the locking plate. So stress riser came around the hole in the fracture site. So next time, what we did, we had a longer plate with a lot of screw. We left this. These two screws are outside the plate, so there are three holes which are not covered. So stress can be dissipated over longer period of the implant. Fracture united again, had a good function, good result. So don't blame the implants. It was same type of implant. Only thing was implant was put biomechanically better to get a better result. But we must understand before fixing proximal ulna. Proximal ulna is not a straight bone. There is a proximal ulna dorsal angulation, which you can see. This is the dorsal angulation proximal ulna. There's a varus angulation. So ulna is not straight bone in both planes. So what pre-contoured plates are, they're curved for the varus, and they're curved dorsally also. So whenever you have a longer or unstable fracture, use pre-contoured plate. It gives a much better result because you can reduce them accurately. Again, example, type 2A comminuted fracture proximal ulna with the radial head dislocation. You fix it with the help of a locking plate. A long screw, home run screw, helps in getting a biomechanical advantage. So whenever you're fixing these fractures, you should always check for the stability and movements before closure, because there could be some block in the rotation if your reduction is not accurate, or there could be subluxation of the radial end. So check it before closure. Another case, 27-year-old male had a RTA injury to the elbow. So radial head was dislocated dorsally, and proximal ulna, comminuted proximal ulna fracture. And there's a fracture of the coronoid, which was fixed with the screws and the plate, radial head reduced. So another case, 54-year-old male had a similar kind of injury. If you see x-rays carefully, the patient has three main fragments. This is a diaphysis, coronoid fracture, a big coronoid fracture, and a big olecranon fracture. So here we can just confirm what we were seeing on the x-ray. This is a big coronoid fracture, olecranon fracture in the shaft, three main fragments, and comminuted ulna. In such cases, first we have to do is get a reduction. And this is how we are fixing the big fracture of the coronoid. We are maintaining the length of the ulna, reducing the radial head. Once radial head is reduced, length of the ulna is maintained, the axis is maintained. Then you put a second plate on the dorsal of the proximal ulna and get a temporary fixation. Look for the stability because it was a comminuted fracture. So all this put in mode. So this is how you're getting a fixation into proximal fragment, distal fragment. This is a long plate. The whole area was comminuted, so everything well reduced, elbow joint stable. Another case, 58-year-old lady had an aortic valve replacement, came with an elbow injury. If you see, look at the CT scan very carefully, there's a big coronoid fracture, there's a proximal ulna fracture, and there's a fracture of the radial head. So this is what confirming what we had seen on imaging. This is a coronoid fracture, big coronoid fracture, as we had seen on CT. It's on the patient. There's a fracture of the radial head. Again, fracture radial head was used. We used a single approach, reflected the fractures. So going through the fracture site, we exposed the radial head, reduced the radial head, fixed with multiple screws, getting an accurate fixation of the radial head, which was fixed with multiple screws. Then used a one plate for fixing a coronoid. These are 2.4 mm locking plate. where you get one or two screws in the coronoid fragment and one or two screws in the shaft of the fragment. So here you have your axis is maintained, your length of the bone is maintained, and radial head is reduced. Radial head is already fixed. This is a Siam picture showing the coronoid well reduced. This is a part of the coronoid. This is the radial head. So they are accurately reduced. Then I use a second plate on the dorsum to get the fixation. And smaller fragments were fixed with the help of sutures. We didn't do bone grafting. It was an acute case. We could get good stable fixation. This was a fixation result after fixation. Radial head was fixed with multiple screws. This plate is holding the coronoid, and this is the dorsal plate for the proximal ulna. Another case, 43-year-old male had a comminuted radial head, coronoid fracture, and the fracture of the proximal ulna. In this case, we used a straight plate. We didn't use proximal ulna plate because we got our reduction with the help of interfragmentary fixation. Once you get an interfragmentary fixation, then a role of locking plate is just neutralizing plate. So you just put the plate and use locking screws. Here we, because the radial head was comminuted, we replaced the radial head. This is the ceramic radial head which we use. We're getting good results in these kind of radial head. And once everything was done, this is how, with the help of pull-out sutures, we reconstruct the annular ligament also. So annular ligament, sutures are taken through the annular ligament, pass through the bone on the medial side. And once we tie the suture, we get a good fixation of the annular ligament, which provides stability to proximal radial ulna joint. So this was a patient post-op X-ray. Same patient, 1 year follow-up. And this was the result, full flexion, full extension, pronation, supination. So had a good pronation, supination, had a good flexion extension. Same patient. So this was a result we can expect after radial head replacement and fixation of the ulna. So in the end, I'll say the complications are there. Posterior intraosseous nerve palsy can be there, especially in type 3 fractures. Radial head instability is there, so we have to take care of it. It is not always just replacing a radial head is important. If you have not maintained your proximal ulna dorsal angulation or varus angulation, then radial head can be unstable. Or if there's a good amount of soft tissue injury, then radial head can be unstable. So either you do a ulna collateral ligament repair, or you do a LUCL repair to get the stability. I didn't show slides for this. I thought Dr. Abhijit would be covering it. So other complication is non-union of the fracture ulna or malunion. Malunion usually occurs when you are using flexible implants like K-wires. Then, as like any other elbow injuries, myositis ossificans is the chances are there, which can be the cause of stiffness. So if we review literature again, it was seen, this was published in 2006, which was a review of 121 cases. Adult population had a commonest injury was trans-olecranon fracture dislocation. That was type 2A of the Jupiter, which was commonest. In conclusion, we can say 2A are the most frequent fractures associated with the radial head and coronoid process. And these fractures were considered negative prognostic factors in long-term functional outcome. But with the advent of more knowledge about elbow biomechanics, with the advent of we are fixing all the fractures very accurately and doing the soft tissue ligamentous repair, the results are not as bad as they were reported in the literature in the last decade. So in recent years, we are seeing much better result in spite of olecranon coronoid fractures or radial head fractures. So in this, a second conclusion is that we should recognize the injuries and anatomical reduction of proximal ulna is important. We should know that ulna is not a straight bone. So many times we are fixing ulna as a straight bone, then there can be instability of the radial head. So other thing is, whenever we are fixing ulna, we should first see that radial head is accurately reduced to the radiocapitular joint, and we should mobilize the mobilize them early to get good results. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas. There is a one question from Dr. Anupam. I am audible? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir,
you're audible. Yes. There is a question from Dr. Anupam Srivastava. From Dr. Vikas.
Sir, we are running out of time. We'll take question later on. I think we'll answer talk.
Okay.
John, sir, can you share your screen, please?
Okay. Now I invite Dr. John. And I welcome you, sir, to the KOA webinar under the aegis of UPOA. He is the director and head of the Mukhopadhyay Research Center, Patna. I welcome you, sir. He will speak on pediatric elbow injuries.
Sorry, I have to just do that again because I shared my screen with my audio off. Is that clear now?
Yeah, it's clear, sir.
Okay, thanks. So I think there's a huge area to cover in this and why isn't this moving? Okay, so I'm going to basically talk a bit about supracondylar fractures and just a little bit about lateral and medial, lateral condyle and medial epicondyle fractures, and just mention crash lesions for those who are unaware of this. So, because there's too much to cover otherwise in the given time. So I think supracondylar fractures is the one fracture that all of us have to deal with all the time, and it's the most common fracture between the age of 1 and 7 and is responsible for a major portion of the hospitalizations in children with elbow fractures. The important thing is the most common complication that we see with it is malunions, but there are other more severe complications which we need to avoid during our treatment. So the mechanism of injury is usually a fall on an outstretched hand, but you do have the flexion type of injury where you may fall directly on the flexed elbow, and you need to really watch out for associated lesions such as nerve lesions and vascular lesions. And so in your clinical examination, you need to make sure that you've checked the pulse, the peripheral circulation, and looked for any nerve injury. So you need to do the so-called OK sign and the other movements to make sure that you are not missing out on neurological injury, because some of them could happen intraoperatively, and if you have not documented it earlier, then it will be assumed to be an intraoperative injury. The things to look out for in your x-rays are the anterior humeral line, which should pass through the middle of the capitellum. Okay, it's a little variable in children, but look at it and you can compare it with the opposite side if you're not sure. Also look at the angle of the capitellum, because there's about a 30 degree angulation that the capitellum makes with the shaft of the humerus. And remember the radiocapitellar line, which should intersect the capitellum in all views. Okay, so this is important. And any disruption of this, you need to view with suspicion. Okay, so now Gartland classified these fractures into three types. In the extension type, you had the type one, which was undisplaced, type two, which was angulated, but the posterior cortex was intact, and the type three was the completely displaced with no cortical contact. Okay, there's also the flexion type, which forms about 4% of these injuries. So the type one is the one that you may miss on x-rays, and here is where you need to look out for things like the fat sign. So you have the anterior fat sign, which you would normally see, and that is displaced upwards, while the posterior fat sign, which is not seen on the normal x-ray. So if you see the posterior fat sign, you should be suspicious. It denotes that there's some kind of hemarthrosis, and you should be on the lookout for any fracture. So the type two fractures will be usually obvious on x-rays, because when you draw the anterior cortical line, it will go in front of the capitulum. And the type three, beware of associated injuries. You could have other fractures in the arm, like distal radius or both bone forearm fractures, which if you're not careful, because usually it means a high energy trauma to cause that much of displacement. So you need to watch out for any other injuries that might be there. And the type four is the severest injury. And this is something that has been described more recently. And this is where there is a multi-directional instability. And these are difficult to reduce and hold reduced in the classical way in flexion. So you need to watch out how you can hold it reduced before you fix it. Now, a type one or two type one fracture doesn't need any surgical treatment. All you do is immobilize in a splint or cast for 3 weeks. And usually that will be okay. But watch out for the varus impacted fracture, okay? That's where you need to look at the Bowman's angle. If you have a varus impacted fracture, it might look very innocuous on the initial x-ray, but the patient will end up with a varus deformity, which parents are not very happy with later. So look out for that. Otherwise, it just needs immobilization and splinting or a cast for 3 weeks. The type two, you need to restore alignment and immobilize in a splint or cast. Now you have to make a decision as to whether you need to fix it. Today, the trend is more towards, even for these fractures, to do a percutaneous spinning to avoid any re-displacement. Now, what is important is you have to be able to flex the elbow enough without there being significant swelling to expect the posterior periosteum to keep the fracture reduced. I think the type three fractures, there's general consensus today that they require some form of surgical treatment. And usually what most people would do is a closed reduction and percutaneous pinning. Today, for fresh fractures, open reduction and pinning should not be required very often. You may occasionally require it for various reasons, but most would respond to closed reduction and some mini open reductions, which there are various tips and tricks for. And you would fix them percutaneously. In the past, there have been things like traction. Some people still like the external fixator for some of these fractures, although this is not widely used by most people. I think when you do your closed manipulation, we would do it under general anesthesia usually. You first give longitudinal traction in mid-flexion, and then you would get the AP, so the fracture reduced on the AP x-ray, and then flex the elbow with your thumb on the olecranon, okay? And when you flex the elbow, always make sure that you check the peripheral circulation and the pulse. So the technique is to check with fluoroscopy is if the fracture is out to length and okay on the AP, then you correct that, and then you flex the elbow and get your reduction, and then check it on your views. Okay, there are some contraindications to non-surgical management, and of course, open fractures, very unstable fractures. If you have ipsilateral forearm fractures or there's a lot of swelling, then conservative treatment is not a very good way to treat this, because you can't flex the elbow enough and then they're likely to displace. Okay, so there are some pitfalls, like I mentioned. If you can't get the elbow flexed to 120 degrees, then there's almost an 86% risk of loss of reduction. Failure to recognize neurovascular problems is something that you need to watch out for. And if you are treating them closed with closed manipulation and conservative treatment, you need to really watch in follow-up that the fracture doesn't displace. So I think today, by and large, for these displaced fractures, most of us would use closed reduction and percutaneous pinning, and some fracture as displaced at this, I think there would be very few people who would treat these conservatively. Your decision on how you pin them is something we'll discuss. Nowadays, the tendency is to use lateral pins only, but some of these fractures, you still may need to add a medial pin if you are worried about instability. And this child did, went on to do well with sort of healing and a good motion. Now, what do you normally do with these when you treat them with closed reduction and percutaneous fixation is to keep them in a cast for about 3 weeks. And at 3 weeks, you would take out the pins and the cast at the same time. So these are the pin configurations which are commonly used. So you have the crossed pin, which is what was the traditional way of doing it. But because of some incidents with ulnar nerve palsies, people try to use sort of only lateral pins. And ideally, you want to put divergent pins rather than parallel pins when you're using lateral pins, because they give you more stability. And this lower pin often goes across the olecranon fossa. So you have a focortical fixation on this pin. And anyway, when you start your motion, you're going to take out these pins, so it doesn't seem to matter. If you put parallel pins, they're not as stable. And those are the ones you may have to supplement with a medial pin as well. It's important that you check your C-arm views, both the AP and lateral, but also get internal and external oblique views to check that the columns are adequately reduced and sort of maintained, because rotation is often the problem. And sometimes you may get a reasonable looking views on your AP and lateral, but because of the rotation, you'll find in the oblique views that there is displacement. Okay, so the advantage of pinning is that it lessens the risk of cubitus varus. And once you've pinned them, you don't need to keep them in extreme flexion. So you can splint them in a bit of extension or 45 degrees flexion till the swelling settles down. Okay, now the other thing that you need to watch out for is some of these patients will come to you with an absent pulse. Okay, so if the patient comes to you and you can't feel a pulse, you need to look at the circulation. If the fingers are pink and perfused and the function is okay, today the tendency is towards conservative treatment for the vascular. So you don't do you don't consider it a vascular injury and go do an arteriography and a sort of exploration of the vessels. Of course, these need urgent reduction. You would reduce it and stabilize it and reassess. A lot of them, the circulation and the pulse will return. However, if after reduction, you still have any doubt about the circulation, then you need to explore the vessel. And it's useful to have a vascular surgeon on standby if you're worried about it. Like I said, open reduction today should not be needed very often, but occasionally you can get interposition of soft tissue, which makes closed reduction very difficult. There you have to decide between using some of the minimally invasive sort of tricks where you put in a sort of pin to lever the fracture out, or rather than attempt multiple attempts at closed reduction, you can resort to open reduction. And one of the advantages of open reduction is that you can get an accurate reduction, and also the hematoma that gets evacuated reduces the swelling that you have in that region. Okay, so you could use various approaches depending on what you're familiar with. Some people use the lateral, some people use medial or an anterior incision, especially if there's any doubt about the vascularity. Okay, so some of the problems that you might have to deal with is irreducibility of the fracture, the compartment syndrome, cubitus varus deformity, and atrogenic nerve injury, which I mentioned, which is of the ulnar nerve. I think You need to watch out for these and try to avoid these complications. And unfortunately, compartment syndrome is still something we see today. It's either due to a tight cast or some of these children who've gone to a bone setter. So here's an example. This child actually came to us quite late. We went initially to a local bone setter who bandaged him tightly, and he developed a severe compartment syndrome. And he came to us 3 days afterwards with no movement and no sensation. Here, you always have this dilemma as to whether at this stage you would do something. I think in the upper limb and in children, I think the threshold is a bit more in that even 2 days or 3 days down the line, if the compartments are really tense, it's worth decompressing. So we went down, we decompressed the entire thing, and this has to be a full decompression from the median nerve beyond the wrist right up to beyond the elbow, the lacetous fibrosis, which you need to release to make sure that all things that are encompassing or pressuring on the muscles or nerves are released. And this was that after the end of the release. We also fixed the fracture at the same time. This is at about 2 months down the line. Not good function. Gradually over time, he actually regained quite a useful function of his limb. Not normal, but quite a useful function of his hand, which he is able to use. I think cubitus varus, again, is something that you want to avoid. But it is almost, you will get them occasionally because either you've not assessed the reduction adequately or they come later. And there, an osteotomy is the answer to try to restore the alignment of the limb and sort of cosmetic correction. The flexion type fracture is something you need to watch out for because these are very unstable. And if you try to reduce and fix them in the extreme flexion position, they tend to displace more. And so some of these you have to kind of extend a bit to get your pins across and then fix them in extension so that you do not further cause more flexion deformity of the fracture. Okay, the transcondylar fracture, this is something that you need to watch out for in neonates and very young children before the sort of distal physis or the epiphysis have appeared or ossified, and they may be hard to diagnose and may be mistaken for a dislocation. But remember that this always moves in the opposite direction of a dislocation. So the distal displacement is medial rather than lateral. And if that happens, suspect a transphysial injury. You need to reduce them and often fix them with K-wires. But if they come late, it is better to leave them alone, especially after 10 days, because they have almost united by then. And there is some amount of remodeling expected in these in the neonates. So we come to lateral condyle fractures, which compromise about 15% of elbow injuries. And the things that you need to worry about is non-union, progressive valgus deformity, tardy ulnar nerve palsy, and instability. Okay, the importance of early diagnosis cannot be because often you will get a misdiagnosis. If you see the original X-ray, even on the I think you need to mute.
Please mute.
Misdiagnosis. At the original X-ray, it was hard to look at to find the fracture, but 10 days later you can clearly see the fracture line, and 3 weeks later you can see it's displaced significantly when he came to us, and then we had to go in and do an open reduction. Luckily this child did well, but the later it gets, the more difficult it becomes to deal with it. And if you have you need to avoid the misdiagnosis with high index of suspicion. The internal oblique view, which is described by Song, is the one that will tell you, will show the fracture line in some of these. And an ultrasound is another way of detecting these fractures early if you have a good ultrasonologist with you. The few important questions that you need to look at before deciding on treatment is whether the fracture is complete or incomplete. Is the articular cartilage displaced or merely hinged, or is the fragment rotated as well? I think this was a fracture which, when we were doing our training, was always considered one that you needed to do an open reduction on and fixation in, but things have changed more recently and some of these can be treated conservatively. And so these are the things that you need to look at. Of course, it's displaced and rotated. You need to fix them. But even those, there's now some authors who suggest that you can do close reduction and pinning. So the stages of displacement, again, all of you are aware of the Jacobs classification. You can call it a gap, which is just a crack, or a gap, or a flip where it's rotated. I think more recently, Song has further sort of classified these in that the type one fracture has been sort of divided into three stages, stage one, stage two, and stage three, depending on how the fracture line goes. So if the fracture line is does not enter the articular surface, then it is considered stage one. If it enters into the articular surface, but the gap laterally is more than medial, then it's stage two. And when the gap is equal on both sides, it's stage three. And stage three would be, so this is based on the Finn-Bogason classification, the stage one, stage two, stage three. And in stage one, it's stable and can be treated conservatively. Stage two, you may treat conservatively, but you need to watch out for displacement. And the stage three are actually unstable and you probably need to pin them rather than treat them just conservatively in a cast. Okay, so those are the treatment options, non-operative treatment or operative treatment. And operative treatment could be pin fixation, which could be closed reduction or open reduction and pin fixation. And traditionally, we would do open reduction and internal fixation for all these displaced fractures and look very carefully at the articular reduction so that we have not so that we have accurately reduced it and fixed it. And you would pass the pins through a different, from outside the incision so that when you remove the cast at about 4 to 6 weeks, you can take out the pins as well. Recently, Song has published on closed reduction and internal fixation of the displaced unstable lateral condylar fractures of the humerus in children. And in this study, three out of the six rotated fragments, they were able to reduce closed and fix with wires. But this is not something, again, which is universally accepted. I think for most people, for the displaced and rotated fragments, open reduction and internal fixation is still the best option. So short this thing about medial epicondyle fractures. These are actually extra-articular fractures. But what you need to watch out for is that some of them are associated with dislocations. Fractures which are displaced less than 5 millimeters, you can definitely treat conservatively. If they're more than five, between 5 and 10, there's some controversy. If it's more than 10 millimeters, then you need to fix them. And the other thing you need to watch out for is whether they're trapped in the joint, okay? So like I mentioned, less than five casting, 5 to 10, there's some, you need to look for any valgus instability and fix them. And if it's more than 10 millimeters, then you need to fix this. Okay, so here's an example of a non-operative treatment where a 12-year-old female was treated non-operatively and was able to get back full mobility and return to sports. The literature is a little conflicted on this. So you have literature saying that you should fix it as well as those which, so this is a one which showed very good results with conservative treatment and another one which showed good results with internal fixation of this. So there, especially in the 5 to 10 millimeter displacement, there's some controversy where it's displaced that much. I think there's no doubt you should fix them. And this is one we did. The dislocations, after you reduce them, you need to watch out for where the fragment is. So I think most of these, if they're dislocated even after closed reduction, we would tend to fix them because they are unlikely to be stable and are sure to be unstable on valgus. And so this is one we fixed, which went on to do well. Watch out for joint incarceration. I think if the fragment after reduction lies in the level of the joint, treat them as if they are incarcerated, okay? So even if you can do a CT or an MRI to check, but if the fragment is in the joint level of the joint, you need to treat them as incarcerated. So here's an example. of a patient who, after we reduced, you can see the joint is fragment is lying in the joint, and those the CT shows it very clearly, and you're going to need to do an open reduction, internal fixation to make sure that the medial epicondyle fragment is nicely reduced and fixed. Watch out for the medial condyle fracture. So in children below 7 years, if you see what looks like a medial condyle fracture, it is more likely to be a medial epicondyle fracture. It's more likely to be a medial condyle fracture because the epicondylar epiphysis is not visible below the age of 8 usually. So watch out for that. And this is a patient who presented late, and you can see this entire medial condyle was involved. And these late reconstructions, you can do them, but the results are going to be compromised. This patient did have some stiffness after the fixation. Also, watch out from late instability. Sometimes these patients will come late, and there you may have to resort to fixation. This patient came to us after 6 months with a valgus instability, but we were able to sort of restore the reduction and fix it adequately to get a reasonable good motion. So the last thing, just the last couple of slides, is about this elbow trash lesions. Okay, so this was written up in 2010 JPO by Peter Waters, James Beatty, and James Kasser. And it's a term coined by James Kasser. And trash means that the radiographic appearance seemed harmless. So these are children with fractures where if you're not trained to look at them, you're likely to miss them. And this is the list of fractures which are included in this, including what I mentioned is the unossified medial condylar fractures. You can have osteochondral fractures, even of the olecranon or the radial neck or head, which you may miss in the younger children. Some of the Montagia types you might miss, and a lateral condylar avulsion shear fracture. So there's a list of fractures which you need to have a high index of suspicion. On your clinical examination, if you see swelling or pain which is out of proportion to what you see on the X-ray, have a high index of suspicion and resort to further investigations. Again, ultrasound is very helpful if you have a good ultrasonologist. MRI is probably the best, but will require often anesthesia in the very young child. And arthrography is the other way to look out for these injuries. And many of them will need open reduction and internal fixation. So the take-home message, I think, with these children's elbow fractures, I think you need to remember the importance of early diagnosis. Look out for any neurological or vascular lesions. I think you need to have a knowledge of when all these epiphyses appear. So that is important, because otherwise you're going to mistake a classical. So some of these as not as fractures, and the other way around. And when you have swelling in the elbow following an injury, but no obvious fracture, have a high index of suspicion. Do further investigations to rule out definite fractures, and be aware of the trash lesions that you need to look out for. Thank you very much for patient attention. So there was a lot to
thank
cover.
Thank you, Dr. Don. For a nice talk on very calm.
So it was wonderful talk, John, sir. I think, Nirva, sir, are you there? Nirva, sir, are you getting us? So I think we'll proceed for the next session. I think that is case presentation. Please take over. John, sir, please be with us.
Yeah.
We'll have questions later on.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah. Nirva,
thank you, doctor. And yes. And now we move ahead with the last session of this webinar, which is on case discussion. Theory has all the knowledge, but we easily correlate our cases with the cases which we discuss here. So it is better to have some case discussion on elbow injuries. And I request Dr. Satya Vamsi Krishna, sir, to please start his screen sharing. Dr. Vamsi, sir. Am I audible?
Vamsi, unmute yourself, please.
Dr. Vamsi, sir.
Okay, hello. Good afternoon.
Yes.
Yeah, it's my pleasure to be part of this webinar. My thanks, Dr. Ajit, Office Bearers of UPA, KOA, Regency Hospital. So as we all know, most of the topics have been covered well by the experts. I should just put some cases for discussion for the faculty as well as the panelists. Ajit, you can please stop me whenever, you know, when I'm crossing my time limits. The purpose of this presentation is, you know, just to have a practical knowledge, and we can have a different view of the all the faculties. So the first case is a straightforward case. So this is a 30-year-old policeman. He had a fall with a outstretched hand. As you can see, this elbow is posterior dislocated, and there is an radial head fracture. So Ajit, you want to take it forward? Like, what do you want to do next when you see this patient in the emergency? And
so I think Abhijit sir is there, John sir is there. I think Kas sir is there. Better panelists are there. That I think people are here. Listen them, not me.
Yeah, okay. Dr. John, you want to take it up, Dr. John? What do you want to do next?
John sir, you unmute yourself.
Sorry, I'll just. Can you just 1 second? No, I'm unmuted. You should be able to hear me.
So, okay.
I was just trying to answer something on the chat. So can you just...
I'll just repeat my question. So this is a 30-year-old policeman with the history of RTA and fall on a outstretched hand. This is his elbow X-ray, and he has no other neurovascular deficits or signs of compartment.
Okay.
X-ray taken in the ER.
Okay, so he has a dislocated elbow, and what you can see clearly on the X-ray is a radial head fracture that is displaced. He's likely to have a coronoid fracture as well, so it would classify as a terrible triad injury, most likely. And the management initially would be to do an early closed reduction and assess stability, and then go on for further investigations like a CT scan, yeah?
Okay. Yes, sir. So as you said, we exactly went into the, we just gave him sedation and reduced the elbow. This is a presentation after the reduction. As you can see, the head is grossly displaced. And of course, it was completely unstable. So the next question would be like, you know, what investigation you want to do it from here? You said CT. What about MRI? Will MRI help at this situation? Do you recommend MRI?
So I think we just we discussed it earlier. I think the CT is more helpful here because you want to look at the fractures. The MRI in this acute situation is really difficult to interpret. And you're going to be, when you're operating on them, you're going to be looking at the lateral collateral ligament right in front of you. Okay, so it's almost always in a situation like this that the lateral ulna collateral ligament is avulsed, usually from the humeral side. And you're going to see it as soon as you do your surgery, if you're planning surgery, okay?
Tell me, sir.
And so I think in this, there's not much doubt that you're going to go in for surgery.
Yeah, so the other problem with MRI is, you know, MRI, I think it overreads. I think, you know, it...
Exactly, that's what I'm saying.
So many injuries. Another thing is MRI not recommended because, you know, to do MRI, the radiographer wants it to be in extension. So you go for extension, I think elbow is going to dislocate. I think in this case, MRI, I think, has no role. I think it's more of a CT and a clinical examination, as you said, sir. So next, of course, this is a CT scan. I don't see a typical coronoid fracture. It's more of a radial head fracture. So
I think, see, this is the problem with these 3D reconstructions. You will not see some of these subtle fractures. Okay, so I think you'll only... I mean, I'm sure if you've looked at all the images, you know about it, but sometimes you can only see it on the 2D with, especially the sort of flake fractures, which are just capsular avulsions from the thing. Okay. So you need to look at the 2D images very carefully as well. Abhijit, you have something to add to that?
No, sir. I completely agree. In fact, I neglect to see the 3D reconstructions and solely rely on the 2D more often than not.
Yeah, actually, I don't have the pictures, but I did see the cross sections, and there was no obvious.
I think if you look very carefully, there's something right. I mean, there seems to be a small fleck right at the tip of the coronoid.
So
the tip of coronoid is.
Yeah.
Vikas, sir, you are saying something.
The tip of coronoid seems to be there's a very small fragment like anteriorly.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
So Vamsi, what you did?
Yeah, so what would be your plan, sir? What would be your approach? You want to go dorsal, caucus, or medial bio? Or what would be your approach, next approach?
So I think my approach or sort of to this is very similar to what Ram had mentioned in his talk, is to start on the lateral side, work through the radial head fracture, okay? look at the coronoid. If it needs fixation, fix it or do a capsular repair there. Then fix the radial head, then deal with the lateral ulna collateral ligament, which would be usually a suture anchor and a repair rather than a full reconstruction. And then check stability for any medial opening, etc. Okay. Now, to some extent, the medial side, even if it's a little unstable, if you keep them in pronation, will heal up. But if it's grossly unstable, then you would need to look at the medial ligament repair as well. Okay.
So one more question for the panelists is, you know, there are two approaches for the radial head. One is the Kaplan approach, and the other one is the standard Coccus approach. So do any of you use a Kaplan approach, or it's only Coccus?
So there are actually three approaches. I mean, some people like to go posteriorly, okay?
Okay.
Rather than laterally, okay? So if you look at the literature, they talk about the lateral and, if necessary, medial approach, and the posterior approach, where they can do both sides through one approach.
Okay, so even if you go posterior again, you have to go through Coccus.
Yeah, you have to go through the same interval. Yeah.
So, but Kaplan's, do you ever use Kaplan's in your practice, sir, or you never use it?
So I haven't used it for the terrible trial. Usually in this, the plane of your dissection is made out with the injury. Exactly. Okay, so when you go there, you actually follow the plane that the trauma has created for you. Okay.
Yes, sir. Exactly, sir. So actually, this patient, I went through the Coccus approach itself.
Yeah.
So actually, this patient had a head, a piece of head as well as a neck. So what happened? Mm-hmm. So here I had to take out the head out, put a headless compression screw for the head, and then, you know, prefix my plate. Okay. As you see here, then I got the plate fixed to the stem. So I think the safe zone, I think Dr. Ajit has already discussed. So the safe zone, what I would other method is to, you know, correlate with the area between the styloid of the radius and the Lister's tubercle. Other one is, you know, I don't know if you can see this, some of the one side of the cartilage is quite thick compared to the other side. So normally they say this part is normally the articulating surface with a sigmoid notch. So you tend to avoid the plate. So even if its plate goes on the articular surface, you can always come back after the union and remove it. So what do you say about this? Do you have anything to add to this or criticize this? Anybody?
So I think, yeah, I mean, if you have to use a plate, that's the right place to put it. But today, where possible, we try to go with screws across to the
neck. You mean from the head to the neck?
Yeah, where possible. I mean, it may not be possible in this case, but we would try to fix it without the plate where possible. Yeah. So I don't know. But Abhijit, how do you look at it? And Vikash?
Yeah, I would put a headless screw from the rim.
Yeah.
From the rim, like from the edge, and going to the metaphysis.
Arteria, yeah.
Metaphysis. Two or three, and they are very stable. Like.
Yeah, that's what I've gone to doing most of the time nowadays. But yes, there will be some where you have to plate because there's too much instability and the fracture extends a little more distally. So there you can't avoid.
Yeah, I agree. I think a screw fixation in a cross manner, two or three screws, and especially the completely threaded screws these days give a very nice fixation.
Yeah. So what I use often are the 2.4 or 2.7 millimeter headless, no, the locking head screws from the small fragment LDRS set. So they bury a lot easier into the cartilage than the screws with the head on it. So, or you can use headless screws for Macrofix or whatever, or Arthrex, they also have.
So what, I mean, like, one is screw fixation is more recommended because it's low profile, but you know, it's technically is not that easy, you know, some cases, you know, So what does the study which says, you know, even most of these neck fractures will invariably go for non-union. But they say as long as, you know, the construct is stable, you can leave it. If there's any problem, you can always come back and go for a replacement or an excision. So that's other way of looking at it.
Yeah, I think the importance in the acute stage is that it fills that void there. So it's a spacer that prevents valgus instability, further valgus instability. Yeah. So it's important to have it there to prevent both instability and possibly proximal migration if you have a intraosseous membrane injury.
Yeah, because you are saying something?
Yeah, but even if it goes in non-union, see, it serves its purpose for soft tissue healing. So we have a couple of cases who went into non-union and they were asymptomatic. We didn't do anything. Yeah. If elbow is stable, everything is good. After 6 months, 9 months down the line, you just remove the implants and excise the radial head. It works fine.
In fact, how many of you in favor of replacement in the primary, as a primary?
Not in something like this. I mean, this is, the head is nice. Why would you replace it? I mean, this you should be able to fix it. If it is so shattered that you can't fix it, then yes. Then a replacement is better than an excision. Yeah.
So coming back to the right side of the image, you can see the topmost X-ray. This is called a typical ulnar sac site. This is taken before the repair of the LUCL ligament. Yeah. So this strongly indicates that ligament is completely torn. And this is the image taken after the ligament was repaired. Okay. So here I didn't use a suture anchor. We use the epibond.
Transverse, yes.
Yeah. So that's the, so do you agree with this, whatever I said, or do you have any?
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, perfect.
So then coming to the medial. So how do you repair the medial at all, or do you assess it, or do you just leave it as it is, even if it's injured? What is your take on that?
So that's what I mentioned, is that after you've done these two, that means you fixed your radial head and your lateral ulnar collateral ligament, you put your elbow through range of motion. And if it is dislocating the moment you extend it beyond maybe 50, 60 degrees of flexion, then I would look at the medial side.
There's another concept saying that, you know, you open the medial side also, there's high risk of stiffness. So so I didn't touch the medial here.
Yeah, so this one I probably wouldn't. I mean, I'm not saying so. It's rare that we've had to do the medial side. And if it gets unstable beyond 30 degrees, then I would keep it in pronation and just avoid hyperextension for some time.
So what will be the post-op here? Because I don't have a dedicated therapist, so I had to immobilize him for 3 weeks and then start mobilizing. I think Dr. Abhijit has already described...
mentioned that. I think he mentioned exactly the same.
Go ahead, sir.
So what we've been doing is to put them in a slab in flexion. And then once the swelling settles down, we allow them further flexion, okay? So, but not extension beyond that, okay? And then only after 3 weeks, gradually increase the extension.
So there is a paper by Hospital of Special Surgery. What they say is, you know, you can make the patient supine and do an overhead flexion extension of the elbow. In that position, the stress on the
less likely to dislocate. Okay.
Yeah. So the stress on than doing against gravity, doing towards the gravity, it's more favorable for the.
Sure. That's less likely to dislocate.
Yeah. Of course, for that you need to have a dedicated therapist. If you have it, that would be a more ideal way of mobilizing it.
Yeah, Abhijit, sir, you are saying something.
Yeah, 2 points. I think let Vikas Gupta first speak.
Okay. Thank you, Abhijit. See, before going medial. When I remove the radial head, I'll just take a sutures from the anterior capsule because it is very rare that we have to do medial and lateral in one go. Usually, I'll take a suture capsule like from the anterior aspect through the same defect from where radial head was taken out and take a pullout suture on the dorsal head. It gives good amount of stability. Second thing is, whenever you're taking, your elbow is open and you're taking lateral view, it is mainly rotation because you're trying to get it like this, so it opens up. So support your arm and get a true lateral. Many times what extra space you're seeing instability in the lateral X-ray in the C-arm, you won't see. It is mainly because of the rotation, and definitely it indicates that your LUCL is deficient.
Okay. Just a very quick point. In fact, you know, and this is, I'm opening the Pandora's box, and this is something that all of us can discuss. So, Satya, when you kind of mentioned this view, the posterior ulnar sac sign, if you watch very carefully, there are two different flexion angles. Now, this could perhaps be an indicator of an instability rather, I mean, a medial collateral, in fact, for that matter. because the opening out and the instability, it's like a posterolateral perhaps because of the lateral collateral ligament injury. But I think it's imperative to also look at the anteroposterior view and look for a stress test as well to assess medial collateral ligament.
Yeah, I think at the end of your fixation of your radial head and your coronoid radial head and your lateral ulnar collateral ligament, I think you need to check that the medial side is stable. But I think having said that, I think probably in all these years, it's once that I've actually also opened the medial side at the same time.
But you know, it also depends on the severity of the injury, I guess.
Oh, absolutely, I agree.
If it is a complete dislocation such as this, the likelihood of a severe tear on the medial aspect is very
possible,
high.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, so I'll go with the next case. Is that okay?
Yeah, I think
one more maybe.
Can we go?
Yeah, so this is another 30-year-old patient. Okay, so he had a history of trauma 3 months back, and as you know, we have it's common to have an osteopath treatment. So this was his X-ray. Okay, X-ray, I think it looks okay, apart from some calcification in the LUCL region, or radial collateral ligament region. So I'll just go to the examination part. So this is some of the tests for the ligaments, where, you know, we asked them to do a push-up, press-ups. So you can see this, there's a dimpling happening here. I think the video is playing well. Can you all see it?
Yeah, it's playing.
See this?
Yeah.
Voluntarily dislocated. And see, this is another test where, you know, you ask him to get up from a chair or a table here.
Left upside.
Yeah, this is this is other video on the, this is a, it's called a pivot shift test, and I did an anterior drawers test both. Pivot test, what you do is you keep the forearm in supination and you give a valgus stress and axial loading. I think when you're coming close to the extension, you'll get this, you know.
Vamsi.
Yeah, tell me, sir.
Quick question. Was this test performed under a block or is a patient?
Without block.
Yeah, so the recommendation is that a pivot shift test should be done under anesthesia.
Yeah, exactly. So I did both.
I think in something like this where he's doing, the chair test is positive, possibly you don't need to do the pivot shift before to confirm it, yeah?
Yeah, so, I think it's self-explanatory.
Yeah, so then, of course, then we went next for the, of course, I got an MRI.
MRI,
as you can see some laxity in the lateral LUCL ligaments. So now coming to the diagnosis, I labeled as a posterolateral rotational instability. Yeah. You all agree with this, or
yep. Do
you have anything?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
So, what would be the approach, sir, Dr. Abhijit? You want to take it since that's your topic?
How old is the injury, you said?
Patient is 25-year-old. Injury is 3 months back. 3 months.
Okay. So, this very clearly from the clinical and the radiological examination points towards what we call as a posterolateral rotatory instability, which results from an insufficiency of the lateral and collateral ligament. And I think for this case, I would prefer a reconstruction rather than a repair. And the favored grafts are either the palmaris longus or a hemi-semitendinosus tendon graft. Sometimes if you're using only the palmaris longus, you may augment it with a suture tape, and you may also use the internal splint, which is available from Arthrex. And they usually give consistently good results.
Yeah, so you're right. So actually, I did a mistake in this patient. Actually, what happened, I was overambitious and went for a, you know, repair of the lax ligaments. So one question to you is, yeah, 3 months, yeah. So one question to you is, how do you assess exactly interop? When is it, when to reconstruct and when to just go for a primary repair? Is there any assessment index or whatever, anything? Or duration or just interop observation?
I think really any time after 4 to 6 weeks, the chances of you being able to get it back in position and repair it are not so great. That is my, I don't know, Abhijit, what do you say?
I completely agree, sir. I think at such a long time with the calcification present, it's a degenerated injury with in a chronicity. So I think reconstruction would be a better idea.
So, I agree.
Longus works well for this, I don't know.
So sorry, actually, I did.
If they have one, some of them don't have a Palmaris longus, so then you have to go.
I did went in with an idea of reconstruction, but you know, I got tempted looking at some tissue there, looked like straight back. But of course, the patient was not completely okay. He did have some residual instability, but he was quite satisfied. So this immediate X-ray, you see here also there is a sag. So then I look back, it says that, you know, when you repair, whenever it's not too strong enough, or maybe, or if you follow up later with a proper physiotherapy, this can subside. So what do you, Dr. Abhijit, if you see this sign on the X-ray, will you be satisfied, or is it okay, you just leave it and come back?
No, I you know, this patient will get symptomatic sometime or the other. Because like I said, the LUCL is a very important stabilizer on the lateral aspect of the elbow, especially for all activities that are in front. So lifting a jug of water for that matter, throwing activities, I don't know if he's a sportsman or something. So
yeah,
they do become symptomatic. And if he does, I think then you before any arthritic changes set in, you should follow this guy up regularly, look for any degenerative changes and propose a reconstruction at the earliest sign or symptoms that he may develop.
Yeah. Fine. Thank you, Dr. Abhijit. So I will go with the next case. Okay. So this is another interesting case. I think this I discussed with Dr. Abhijit a couple of months back. So this is a lady, she had a trauma and she had a dysrhythmia fracture. I think the primary surgeon forgot about the elbow injury and he fixed only the radius. So when she came to us, she had more of, you know, pain and instability in the elbow. And on examination, you know, there was a multi-directional instability in all directions, which was painful, but the range of motion as such was pretty okay. So this was the X-ray, as you can X-ray and the CT scan. Here you can see there is a posteromedial subluxation. Okay, so the, now the patient has a clinically a multi-directional instability and a posterolateral subluxation on the X-ray. So how do you proceed? Anyone of you want to take it?
So this is a dislocated elbow.
Dislocated elbow with instability.
Yeah, I mean, it's bound to be unstable in the dislocated position, isn't it? Unless it's stiff.
Yes, no, it's not stiff. It's totally
so up. So it's bound to be unstable in that position. So yeah, but definitely here's, it's a situation where you're going to have to assess with an MRI to look at the ligaments. And you're going to have to reduce it and then reconstruct the ligaments. I mean, probably both sides here.
Yeah, exactly. So,
yeah, Vikas sir, you're saying something.
I'll open up posteriorly midline because that will give me choice to go both.
Both sides, yeah.
I can see laterally there is some amount of avulsion from the lateral epicondyle.
Yeah, there's a bit here.
So I'll go posterior midline, LUCL repair, check for varus valgus after the repair, intra-op only. If medial, it's opening up more than 2 millimeter. At the same time, we'll go for medial repair.
Yeah, there's something on the medial side here as well. If you look at the medial epicondyle, there's a small
lateral there as well. I could see laterally also.
Yeah, on the medial side, on this, on the CT scan number C, on the medial side, you can see a small fleck as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll just go with what I've said. Okay. So this again, I assessed under anesthesia, and of course, there was still an instability. And of course, as you said, I went through the dorsal universal approach. And then I took a, you know, of course, his main techniques are there. This here, I took a gracilis graft actually. As you can see, one end I put a endo button, other one is just a free end. So I, you know, released all the capsules, the scarred ligaments, isolated the ulnar nerve, and then I went for the reduced the joint and went for the reconstruction. So this is what I did. So the graft, what I did was made a tunnel through the sphincter as well as the sublime tubercle, got it out. I reconstructed the LUCL first, stabilized it here with the interferential screw, then again got back to the ulna, which is for the medial posterior medial medial collateral ligament, and again stabilized with another interferential screw. So this is what I did, where, you know, I could get both the ligaments. So are you all
3 o'clock?
So this was the intra-op images where showing the graph. So this is a X-ray post-op, I mean, not a follow-up X-ray out around 3 months where you can see the unlocated elbow. So this is actually, this technique was adopted from Dr. Greg Bean and Juan Reed. And actually I also published this, the same case. It's something that will be out next month. So any comments, anything to be added or anything change?
I think it was a wonderful case, Vamsi.
Okay, so yeah. Do we have time for next case or should we?
I think we should. It's already 2 o'clock. I think it's time we should.
Yeah. I think this is time to, we all have a.
We have other.
It's long time. As well. And yeah. Okay, I think there are wonderful cases, Vamsi.
Yeah.
We are really, I just want to thanks to all the speakers and, you know, all the viewers who are watching us. It was a wonderful sessions, wonderful lectures, so many cases. We are really blessed that you all have a spare time and join us on this Sunday, afternoon Sunday. So as we are passing through the very tough time, you know, that everyone has a lockdown and, you know, that the everyone is locked in the home. We don't have you access to the, you know, that the any kind of entertainment. So it's a tough time for all of us. We are, you know, that the this is a stress for the everyone is in the financial, social, mental, physical, all kind of stress we are facing. But I think this is high time to hold our hands together, take care of our the near and dear ones, and we should stand together because. I think I'm sure we will come out of from this because God is with us. So you take very best care of yourself, your family members, your near and dears, your friends. I think everything will be fine. Thank you. Thank you all for anything.
Thank you very much.
Anyone to add something? Anyone to say something?
Okay. So there was someone asked about fasciotomy after 2 or 3 days. Yes. So certainly in the lower limb. This is something which would be fraught with danger, but upper limb, especially in children, we've gone quite late. Okay, so as long as it's tense and it's causing a problem, we go in even if it's 3 or 4 or 5 days even down the line, because we can get rid of all the dead tissue at the end. I mean, so yes, so. Of course, you have to look at the clinical picture. If there's already signs of gangrene or something, then they end up with amputation. Okay, but some of these do functionally reasonably well. Lower limb is a totally different kettle of fish because there you have, if you do something after 24 to 48 hours in the tibia, a patient who might not need an amputation will need an amputation. Okay, having said that, you also need to watch out for other complications because if the compartment syndrome is really bad, they can get renal and renal problems as well as associated with kind of a crush syndrome kind of situation. So you need to watch out for those as well.
EIC.
Yeah.
Disseminated intravascular.
Yeah.
Okay.
Lamba sir,
you are saying something?
I have one question from Dr. Vikas.
Yes, sir, please.
Can I have it?
Sure, yeah, sir. Yeah, definitely, sir.
How will you manage the case of posterior intraosseous nerve involvement with Montasia?
See, if it is an acute fracture, most of the time it is stretch of the nerve. So you can do the reduction and fixation. Or if you, because wrist is normal, in these cases, it is thumb and fingers mainly involved. Wrist extensors are good. So you just wait and watch for 6 to 12 weeks. If it recovers, okay. If it doesn't, I'll not suggest to go for a exploration initially because most of the time it is stretch.
Yeah, but there's actually, interestingly, in children in the type 3 Montagia,
it can be entrapment.
Chinese paper which looked at sort of 8 cases and found that in 4 or 5 the nerve was entrapped. So they recommend in the children with type 2, you may have to explore them. Okay.
Thank you.
But even there, I think you need to watch. I think reduce it. If you get a good reduction, then I would wait and watch If your reduction is not adequate, then you need to.
So that means soft tissue is getting.
Yeah, something is soft tissue. Okay.
Thank you.
One question, actually, one question was asked: radial head relocation before fixation. Yeah, we have to relocate radial head. Once we fix, it is difficult to relocate. So at the time of temporary fixation or before fixation, radial head to be relocated. Otherwise, once you fix it with your locking
plate, we lost you. We can't.
Sorry.
Yeah, you're audible, sir.
Now you're audible.
The question was from Dr. Anupam that you have to relocate first. Yes, you have to relocate the radial head first before fixing the ulna. If you fix your ulna and radial head is still dislocated, then it is difficult for to relocate it.
Yeah, so the idea is to get your length and your angulation right of the ulna, and then usually the radial head will come back into position.
Okay, sir, I think we have all the questions. Any comment faculties or the speakers want to put? I think it's most welcome.
I think it was excellent. As usual, you learn quite a lot. I mean, I keep learning things whenever I listen to other people, and especially people like Abhijit, Vikash, etc. It's always great fun. Yeah.
we are really blessed that, sir. John, sir, you have joined us, and it was a wonderful talk, and you have highlighted many things which people are not aware about that. So many, many thanks to you, sir.
No, pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhijit, sir.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Sir.
All the best, and stay safe. Yes. I think things are really getting bad around a lot of
places. Stay safe, sir. Everyone.
Yeah. Take care.
Have a nice afternoon.
Thank you, sir. Vamsi, are you there?
Vamsi?
I think he left. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Bye.
Ravi, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Jit.
Thank you, sir. Kanpur wale sabse kam join kiye hain, sir, shayad?
Nahin, 15 se 20 log join kiye hain, maine sab dekh liya.
Achha.
Haan, achhe join kiye hain, theek hai. 40 members the jo join kiye. Achha, bahut. मतलब फैकल्टी बहुत अच्छी थी और कंटेंट बहुत अच्छा था
ऑर्थो टीवी पे देयर 500 पीपल हैव सीन
अच्छा वेरी गुड
500 पीपल ऑन द ऑर्थो टीवी यूट्यूब अराउंड 150 पीपल एंड अपने जूम पे अराउंड 70-80 पीपल हैव
सीन हमारे अभिजीत सर बिल्कुल वंडरफुल हैं यार वास्तव में बहुत बढ़िया बोलते हैं यार मतलब गजब बोलते हैं मतलब उनका जो टॉक है या जो बोलने का तरीका और समझाने का तरीका है इट्स वंडरफुल It's wonderful. मतलब वो कोई मैच नहीं कर सकता even डॉक्टर जॉन भी मैच नहीं कर पा रहे थे उनको जो उनका तरीका था बताने very good fantastic
overall okay. I think it was very good
yeah. very good
okay, sir. Now I think
yeah.
okay now I'll stop
okay, sir. Thank you. It was a very good webinar thank you everybody
thank you sir
God, sir.